shot, but...
Welcome to The Hook on Woodward Sports Network, Detroit's all-digital sports network, live from my bookie studios. I'm Pilar Lastra. We've got D-Mac. We've got Tom Mazawey. We've got Fish in the Fish Tank. Eazy D behind the glass. It is Wednesday, May 19th. Happy hump day.
I found hair ties.
Excellent. Oh!
I did, yes.
In Maz's car?
What's that? Yeah, it's, don't tell Abby or Maddie that I borrowed them. Your car's very clean, Mass.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Always. Man, it's summertime. It's time to keep your car clean.
It's summertime in southern Michigan.
How you keep your car is usually how you live your life, if you ask me.
Yeah.
Well.
Come see my car. See my car. Absolute chaos.
So,
my car reminds me of the smoke shack. Absolutely, 100%.
Okay, so.
Do you take out extra lease insurance when you take those out?
I don't need to because I am privy enough to have people that let me drive these vehicles.
I love it. Good for you.
Well, so.
Or I buy, but that's, Tom, that's why I buy cheap man vans. Cheap man vans. Drive them till they're done. You know, I mean, there's a man van commercial. They're not minivans. They're man vans.
There's a lot to be said about how you treat your car and how you treat the people in your life and how you treat your life in general. Like, I'm a firm believer on that, right? But I also feel that sometimes things can be misjudged. Like, there's people who they've got their cars a mess. But they will never skip an oil change. They never let their car run on empty. Like, the mechanics on their car are always tip-top. They'll run till they're 300,000 miles.
Pilar.
But it's just a little messy. I'm just saying.
I only have so much compassion, and I choose it for the right human beings and for animals, right? So a vehicle is like a hockey stick to me. They're dispendable. We can get a new one. Let's go. What are you in for? So that's just me.
Remind me not to drive
your car when you're done with it.
You're never allowed to. There's nothing left of the car when I'm done with it. They give me all the ones that they want to bury.
Y'all know that I wrote a book called Treat Me Like Your Car. It's a man's guide to treating a lady.
No, I didn't know that.
Yes.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
Well, you should be handing out.
So
you should be loving my car
then. It was a long time ago, and it was... The basis is that a lot of times relationships are like cars. You know, if you do the bare minimum scheduled maintenance, they're going to last you a lot longer than if you're always skipping the maintenance. And then if you just keep trading them in, then you're going to keep having to keep trading things in.
But eventually, you over-maintenize them and then they move on to another owner?
Yeah.
Is that what it is? Is that chapter in the book?
No, that's called like when you're really good on your lease, you know? And then the next owner's like, damn, this one's good. That one's like. You know, you don't run over on the miles and stuff and you turn it in and you're like, wow. Yep. I have a lot to say about this. This one, my friends.
It's fine. Bring it
up.
But
Maz, why don't you hit us with your sports update?
I will. Good days in sports here in Detroit. It's turning around, folks. I'm telling you. Hop on board. We're getting our chance again. And thanks to our good friends at mybookie.ag. They're, of course, our studio sponsor, and they sponsor our sports update. Make sure you use the promo code Woodward. They will match your first deposit all the way up to $1,000. And even that, we'll even give you a free gift. Use Woodward 10. We'll give you a free $10 play. I hit the three-team parlay last night.
Ding, ding.
We're going to do it again tonight. Tigers, meanwhile, go for the sweep in Seattle. They have won 7 of 9. Spencer Turnbull is the man here in Detroit. He threw the 8th no-hitter in Tigers history last night while most of you were sleeping.
Just because you were.
Turnbull, one strike away from history. To the back of the mound, grabs the rosin bag, bounces it off the back of his hand one more time and drops it to the ground. Climbs up the hill and settles in on the first base side of the rubber. Cabrera well off the line at first. The Tigers shift 3 to the left on Mitch Haniger, the best hitter in this Mariners lineup. Turnbull sets the 0-2 pitch. Swing and a miss! History! Spencer Turnbull has become the sixth Tiger pitcher to throw the eighth no-hitter in franchise history. His teammates burst out of the dugout and mob him at the mound.
Wow.
Dan Dickerson with the call, of course, on Tigers Radio. Can't beat that call. And how about Spencer with a little shaving cream pie after the game, catching up with the guys?
Honestly, warming up in the bullpen, I felt horrible. My mechanics were not clicking at all. I was like, all right, it's going to be a mentality day. We're just going to have to fake it till I make it today. And after that first, I started to click in a little bit and felt really good in the second. Like I said, whatever it was, I was really off warming up in the bullpen, but I just said a quick little prayer and just like, all right, we're going to go for it. Whatever I got today is what I got.
Hey, you ever have those kind of days, Mac, when you didn't think you were going to have a good game?
Absolutely, Maz. But the beauty of playing the way that I did is that
we couldn't tell.
I was brutal. You couldn't tell. But to get into the game for me was to put the body on somebody. Or if you were in a bad mood, go pick a fight. Yeah. You know, I mean, it was a lot easier than it is for a goal scorer or something. And I know people aren't watching NHL playoffs, but if you are, I want to say is that that's what you see. And you saw it with the Las Vegas team. Maz just gave himself some props on a 3-team parlay. I'm 3-0 in the playoffs. So you saw it with the Vegas Knights last night, is that once they finally cracked, you know, it's a 0-0 game going into the midway through the second, two goals go in, and then Vegas finds their guns, and Alex Tuck, who's one of their snipers, needs to score. He scored, but that's the way it is. You catch momentum. What I loved about Spencer Turnbull there, Maz, was Eric Haas. I'm going to get into it more when we talk about Double D. But the mass toss. When you're a catcher, I love a catcher. Pilar, if you don't know this, that my lifelong dream would have been to be the next Lance Parrish of the Tigers.
Big wheels.
Wow.
Right? Exactly. So the thing is that if you watch, and if you go back to Jack when Lance is celebrating his no-hitter, you go to Verlander's, both his no-hitters. You know, and Avila, I remember on the second one against Toronto. And then to last night, Haas, not only is he caught two AAA, two homers, but whatever else, but the mass toss and the hug right there, that was, if I'm grading it, 9.5.
Wow.
9.5, just the way.
I love him.
And to hear Spencer Turnbull talk, and this is what I want to ask Double D when we get talk to him later on in this hour, is the fact that he said, I just love throwing a Haas, and it was just like playing catch, and it wasn't one of those easy games. Sometimes greatness comes out when you don't think you have your greatness, and he was the epitome of that, saying he didn't have his stuff in the show.
Right.
Well, the first no-hitter since Justin Verlander threw it in 2011, as Mac told you. The fifth no-no of the year, by the way, six if you count Mad Bum's seven-inning one. The Mariners have been no-hit twice in 2 weeks. The Indians have been hit no-hit twice this year. So a lot of no-hitters going on, but you don't get a no-hitter without a great defensive play. Check out Jamer Candelario in the seventh.
Special, but
Craig Nettles.
Point it wasn't. 2-1 to Haniger.
Oh, yes. By Candelario. What a play.
Oh,
baby. Saved extra bases down the line, snared it, and threw it.
That was his gold glove, Brooks Robinson.
Every special night needs a couple of special defensive plays. This is the first one for Detroit.
Yeah, you nailed it there, Shep. It seems like you have to have everything lined up, and you need some defense like this. I certainly did when I was lucky enough to throw mine. Look at this. Jamer Candelario, have a night.
How about that?
Wow.
Thanks to Valley Sports Detroit, Matt Shepard, Jack Morris.
Here's Kyle
for
Seager.
The call. So a great one there. You need that. How about a week like he was talking about for Dearborn Divine Child's Eric Haas? Called up a week ago. First Tigers rookie to catch a no-hitter. He also has two home runs, batting .300. Oh, by the way. Same two teams tonight. You better stay up. You never know. Tarek Skubal and Logan Gilbert from Safeco. Shohei Ohtani, show me the money again.
That's the one pitch that Shohei has had a little trouble with.
Oh, there's that sound again, Maz.
Wow.
Look where he hit that. I said that to Eazy when he said it to me, and Easy's at the line of the night. Eazy's me gusta last night was who pisses hotter, Medina Spirit or Shohei Ohtani? Just because he's I like that one.
This guy, he's a unicorn. That's what he is. League-leading 14th home run of the year. Oh, by the way, he pitches tonight against the Indians, who have been no-hit twice. Can he come back with a no-hitter tonight? I bet you probably get what, plus 25,000 tonight on that? On my bookie?
Man,
let's check it out.
I don't know, but let's look it up. Let's look it up Jeff or Mike. Mikey TikTok said, by the way, that Scooble's going for the no-hitter tonight back-to-back. And Maz just said, what'd you say? I just hope he what?
I hope he keeps it under 7 runs. That's all. No, he's getting better. Anyway, the Angels are going to be without Mike Trout. There's the downside of Shohei Ohtani on the Angels. No Mike Trout for almost 2 months. Out with a calf injury. How about the Lions? They got their man with the number one pick, of course, 7th pick overall, Penei Sewell. Today they locked him up. Guaranteed 4 years, $24.1 million, almost $15 million up front in a signing bonus. So we got our guy. NBA playoffs underway with the play-in games. Pacers knocked out the Hornets last night, 144-117. Indiana plays the Wizards next for the 8th seed on a date with number one Philly. Washington, they lost to the Celtics, 118-100. Boston moves on. They get the number two Nets in the next series. The West play-in games tonight. Spurs and Grizzlies from Memphis, and the one everyone's waiting for, the Warriors in L.A. against the Lakers. Here's Draymond Green.
I'm excited as hell. I think, you know, playing against the Lakers, defending champion, with an opportunity to solidify our spot in the playoffs. The stage doesn't get any bigger in L.A. I've been very vocal about the play-in tournament, but this is great. I'm excited about this. This is a great opportunity for us.
Thanks to ESPN, Rachel Nichols, and The Jump. Always a good show. Looking forward to that one. NHL Stanley Cup playoffs. Full slate tonight. Game 3, Caps and Bruins from Boston. That series tied at 1. Canes host the Predators. Carolina up 1-0. Blues in Colorado. The Avalanche leads it 1-0. The President's Trophy winners. And the Jets and Oilers finally get going out west in Game 1 from Edmonton. Looking forward to seeing who from Edmonton, Mac?
Connor McDavid. Connor McDavid. Leon Draisaitl, the best 1-2 combinations. He's must-see TV. There's a couple guys in this league. One in Colorado, Nathan MacKinnon. Chris Draper touched on him.
Yep.
An amazing, amazing, talented for their line of their captain, Gabriel Landeskog and Mikko Rantanen. They're one of the best lines. But Connor McDavid and Leon Draisaitl, what they've done with the points. And this is put up or shut up for Uncle Ken Holland in Edmonton. They got a tough road to hoe. I told you before. Winnipeg's a tough place to play, and when they have to play there, but they're a tough team. So, I mean, I think maybe that could be an upset this series.
Wow.
But, yeah, I think and it all comes down to goaltending. So, which is so cliche in the playoffs, but it's true. It's goaltending, staying healthy, and getting that bounce.
Grant Fuhr ain't in Edmonton the last time I checked.
I know that's what's hurting them. He was awesome.
How about last night? Penguins over the Isles 2-1. That series tied at 1. The Tampa Bay Lightning, the Stanley Cup champs, take care of business. They beat the Panthers 3-1. They're up 2-0. Panthers are in trouble now. Vegas beat the Wild. D-Mac's best bet, 3-1. Series tied at 1. And, of course, we told you Jeff Blashill gets a one-year extension here in Detroit. We take you back to 1998. On this day in sports, we take you to Yankee Stadium. It's the Orioles and the Yankees and another fight. Armando Benitez from Baltimore throwing at my man Tino Martinez. You don't do that.
Ooh, that's going to call. Yeah, he's going.
Hit him between the 2 and 4.
Benches are going to empty. That was a frustration pitch on Benitez's point. No need for it. Darryl Strawberry's after him now. And Benitez, because of all the frustration.
Oh, my
God.
He's 27.
They're after him.
I mean, how they run and swing like that and...
This is getting ugly now.
It's not over. It goes into the dugout.
Somebody's going to get hurt.
Comes another one.
Ellie Hendricks trying to calm Joe Girardi down. But Tino, irate, and I don't blame him.
Me neither.
I mean, there's one thing about making a hitter move his feet, but when you just
blink the baseball game and brought to the hockey game book up.
I mean, Perry just went around the bases, didn't show anybody up, and the guy. To me, when a pitcher does that, it's showing that he has no confidence that he can get people out. I know he's frustrated. He gave up the
it's
home
not
run.
Over.
Whoa, but this is just going to lead to something else in this series. And
what happened
right
there?
Down.
I know. I feel like you
Somebody's
need to rewind it. I missed
Warriors.
It. Who threw what? That almost looked like it was from a fan.
That's usually the way it happens, though, Pilar.
Was it a fan? They threw something?
No, it wasn't a fan. It was Benito. It was
in the dugout. That's something. They didn't like each other.
Clearly.
Yanks and O's. They still don't like each other.
Why'd Joe grab the straw dog?
Huh?
Why you grab strawberry?
Joe Torre's taking
alone.
Him out. He's got to protect this guy.
Yeah,
get in right.
There.
He won a World Series that year, by the way.
I know.
That was a hell of a Yankee team.
Favorite?
That was a hell of a Yankee.
Was your favorite?
My favorite Yankee team?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
No, but it was a hell of a Yankee team. My favorite Yankee team was 1977 and 78.
Reggie Jackson.
Yep.
All right.
And the comeback.
Were you watching it back then?
Absolutely. Little Tommy Mazawey? You can't see little Tommy Mazawey with his little freaking Yankee hat on.
I've been watching baseball since.
How old were you in 78?
In 78, I was 16.
Oh, gosh. I think you're so much younger.
Thank you. I've been watching baseball since 1970, and I remember everything back those days.
Remember, this week it was yesterday. Baseball.
You know what game? You know what made me fall in love with the game? When I saw the All-Star game at Tiger Stadium. In 1971, I just completely fell in love with it. And I said, that's the stadium I want to go to. They got the stars in the outfield. They had it all painted in the outfield. I couldn't wait. First thing I wanted to do when I came to Michigan was go to Tiger Stadium. And, of course, I fell in love with it. It is my favorite stadium of all time, of any stadium, is Tiger Stadium.
Wow.
And I've been to a lot.
I love it.
I love
anybody who had that experience. You know, it's along the same ilk as like Joe Louis Arena with a lot of the memories.
Love the Joe, man. You know how I feel about the Joe.
I know. Those are the hometown barns.
Yep.
It's funny, Maz, because in my hometown of Leamington, the rink that used to be out at the horse track that I grew up in skating, and it was like literally it was about the size of this room, right? So it was a little shoebox. It tore down, and I've never played in the new Kinsman rink. Where they have the new rink now, they attached it to what used to be the community pool when I was back there. So I still haven't played in there. So it's a different time. And without that rink at a mile away from my house that I could go to and skate whenever I needed.
It wouldn't be you.
Things like that. I mean, you look at some of the guys that grew up so close to a golf course, and they'll say, I used to just walk to the golf course after I was done with my homework or whatever. I mean, it's things like that that gives you the ability to really excel in your sport, have the opportunity to practice.
There he is.
Look at that face. Tom Mazawey, you're so cute.
Look at those cheeks.
Look at that. Oh, the hair.
Thanks, Eazy.
Oh, my gosh. It's so cute.
Thank you.
So cute.
Don't yell at Maz. You're yelling at little Tommy Maz.
That was 1970 Pee Wee Jets. They were undefeated champions that year.
Nice. Oh.
Beat the Cowboys in the Super Bowl.
Oh, right on. That sounds apropos.
Hell yeah. Screw the Cowboys.
Screw the Cowboys.
And they tried to play their A-team in the fourth quarter when we beat their ass already. And you're supposed to put the B and the C's in the fourth quarter. We caught them. We punished them.
So you have to make sure that
you just throw your A's back in and punish them, or did your B's punish them?
No, the coach wanted to walk off the field, actually. Coach Joe wanted us to walk off the field, but we stayed on and we played on. I got to get in there. You know, I was a B and a C guy.
I love it.
I love that. I love that.
Mostly C.
This guy was causing havoc back in the day.
Look at
that. Right?
We had the lightning bolts on our shoulders.
I wish I could have seen you play some real baseball.
Baseball I could never play. I loved wiffle ball, though. Stick ball. Loved
stick
ball.
I never played any of that.
It's a great game, man. I just can't play it very well.
Yeah,
I do love it though.
But it doesn't. But
you would have been fighting like the guys.
That's
the
whole
point.
I don't care what sport it is. You don't need to play it to love it. You know, everybody has an affinity. Whether it's stadiums, teams, players, why do you watch? It's no right or wrong.
Hey, I took the lemon drops to the championship.
How about last night?
We got beat. St. Louis
both.
Beat us.
St.
Louis
both
swept
games.
Us.
You were guaranteed.
St. Louis.
God damn it, Tom! I put 20 on the double dipper there. You didn't tell us you lost that.
We got
you won the three-team parlay in the MLB.
They had all eighth graders, and I got fourth and fifth graders on my team.
Oh, I don't want excuses.
Cheating.
I want results.
We're going to be tough.
Okay. You'll
play
get there. You'll get there.
St. Anne's got a hell of a pitcher, though. We'll see how it goes.
Okay. Oh, you're not guaranteeing it
today? I can't guarantee this one.
All right.
All right, guys. Oh, Maz, great sports update.
Thank you.
Great, great clips, too. That last one was amazing. I feel like the best part of going to a hockey game and the best part of going to a baseball game is the fights breaking out. In hockey, we expect them a lot more. It's a real treat when it happens in baseball, though. That's kind of what I feel.
Well, you know, other sports really don't do it properly.
They don't fight. I mean, they don't football doesn't to. Fight. They don't. Very rarely do you ever see a real fight break out. I mean, very rarely.
We always love guys that are punching helmets.
It's so dumb. I mean.
I digress. I punch helmets, too, but it's to punch them off. And they're not. And they don't have big face masks. Well, some of them didn't. You punch them off. You can punch off hockey. You can punch
Andre Johnson
hockey helmets
had a really
off.
Good fight
I punched
time.
Them off, and I've had mine punched off, literally.
Ooh.
I got hit with a punch in a fight my rookie year against Dean Chenault, who I'd fought five times in the minors the year before. Hit me with a punch on my helmet, and then I couldn't see because of blood. He pressure cut me for 40. I split like a split like an acorn.
Wow.
Well, that doesn't split. I guess more like a melon. My melon split like a
that's
melon.
That's what made you who you stitches.
Are. 40 stitches. Still got stitches. The divot.
Ugh. God, that's aggressive.
Robin's racing.
Fish, we got a phone call.
Yeah, quick one before we get to our guest.
Okay.
Pete, who wants to school you on not going to the Baseball Hall of Fame, Maz.
All right.
Oh, all right, Pete.
I don't blame him.
Welcome to the show, my friend.
Hi, guys. How's it going?
Hey, Pete.
We're great.
Okay, my wife and I went to the Pocono Mountains for our honeymoon, and after we were done with honeymooning, we went to the Baseball Hall of Fame in 1989, okay? And 25 years later, we went back to the Hall of Fame for our 25th anniversary.
That's amazing.
Not a bit. I'm glad you went, man.
Is that your favorite?
You made up for me.
I've been to Toronto. I've been to hockey one. I haven't been to basketball one. I went to college football. But, yeah, but so far, baseball is my favorite, all-time favorite.
Aw, I love that. And I love that you went back on your 25th anniversary.
That's
Let me tell you a little story.
Are you sure you're not related?
I Pete know. I feel
related
like.
Maz and Kathy. I mean, there might be. I'm going to do this Ancestry.com. Stay tuned next time you call, Pete. Well, I'll have more information for you. Hopefully those results
Rose
may back
I, hey,
faster than Medina Spirit.
Rose and I went to the Cooperstown Diner, right? When we first went there on our honeymoon, and the guy came along and said, hey, come sit by me. There's nowhere to sit. It's a small diner. So as we go to leave, okay, where's my bill? The guy already paid for it.
Oh, that's Sweet. So nice. That's amazing.
Good things happen to good people.
Because he liked Rose. That's why.
Yeah.
Good things happen to good people, Pete.
Thanks for the call, buddy.
Yeah, great stories, Pete. We always love to hear from you guys. So keep giving us a call, 313-552-6322. And also make sure that you hit us up on our social media at Woodward Sports. Who's manning our social media today? Is it Jeff?
Jeff's
it
on it.
Oh,
he's on
here.
It.
Where is he?
But he's in the back. He's doing double duty today.
Oh, Jeff. All right, our man Jeff. I don't know if we got a new
nah,
person today.
He's doing
today.
Good job. Good job.
Yeah, we love Jeff.
Luke listening at home. Doing
we
his
love
thing.
You, Luke. We hope to see you soon. So keep hitting us up on our social media at Woodward Sports. When we come back, Dan Dickerson, the voice of the Detroit Tigers radio. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. You're tuning into The Hook.
Hey, it's Joey from Woodward Sports at my favorite downtown Fenton Bridge Street Exchange. Let's go check out their beautiful store. You know we love Michigan summers. Got to turn up on the lake. Pre-made mixed drinks. They even got their own beautiful Bridge Street Exchange t-shirts. I got mine on. Jewelry, they got you here. I got mine on. Titanium Buzz. If you're not quite ready to ask that big question yet with the jewelry, look nice for your girl. They got polos. And last but not least, the most comfortable shoes on the planet. Hey Dude. They're literally called Hey Dude. Shop here at Bridge Street Exchange, downtown Fenton. Support a locally owned business.
Start a new career in an industry that is always essential, the heating and cooling industry. Learn more today by visiting northwesterntech.edu. Welcome back to The Hook on Woodward Sports Network. All right, guys, we're going to have Dan Dickerson joining us here shortly. If you guys want to hit us up on our social media at Woodward Sports, we might be able to squeeze in some of your questions. Tigers are starting to
playing good.
Heat up.
Yeah, they're playing. They're playing well.
You know what? One of the big things, and this is where you look at a team that's young and it's trying to find an identity, and we can pick off all the bad things we want or the deficiencies in the general manager and we don't have anything coming down the pipe. This is a great thing for these guys to rally around. And there's one thing that I heard last night from Eric Haast, again, the catcher, is that the locker room is having fun. And even when AJ Hinch at his post-game interview said, well, I told the boys to enjoy this one because it's about along the way. And it'll be interesting to hear from Dan Dickerson's point of view, who has called a few of these before, but did it feel like a no-hitter last night to go into it? But I think this is something that the guys as a whole and the team, they don't care about the outside. They care about themselves, and this will catapult because Spencer Turnbull is their grinder, seven-year guy, yep, not given to him. You know, my big thing was how Jack and Simo and everybody as the alumni or the they felt, and you could hear it in their emotions, so.
Hey, earlier today on MLB Network, one of my favorite things to watch, by the way, they caught up with A.J. Hinch literally on the streets of Seattle, and they asked him, you know, how it felt day after, what he talked to his young club, a little bit off what you were saying, Max. So here's A.J. Hinch with the guys from MLB Network.
Joins us from Seattle. A.J., we appreciate the time. What is that? What was that moment like, not only just for Spencer, but for your ball club that has so many young players that are trying to find their way into the league?
It was pretty cool, you know, and in the momentum of no-hitters always start to build and grow and build. And there was a little sense that something cool was going to happen as the night progressed. But and Candy makes a great play down the third baseline, and then all of a sudden you start counting outs, and everybody was way into it. I love the fact that our guys were into it, and you know, it's a true team effort when you do that. There were a couple good plays earlier in the game as well, but man, we wanted him to get it at the end. And after we tacked on a few runs in the top of the ninth, and then it was kind of anticipation from there.
And Spencer said to Haniger, "I'm throwing as hard as I can. Hit a home run. Yeah. I'm giving you everything I got." What did you say to him post game, AJ?
So post game, I just told him how proud I was of him. You know, I've been fortunate. This is my fifth no hitter as a manager, and every one of them are really special. And you know, I just told him he's worked really hard. He's had this stuff for a while.
Good stuff, man, from AJ Hinch in a street in Seattle, and then Ben Verlander, who follows this Tigers team. He's got a great podcast, by the way. It's Justin's brother. He put out this great tweet. Check this out. I mean, he's into this team. That was his tweet. From my brother 10 years ago to my good buddy now. Wow.
Wow.
Baseball sure is beautiful. I just think it's great. You know, these guys, Justin Verlander don't work here anymore. You know,
right.
And his brother is still following this team. And, you know, we talked to Mark Schlereth, and Daniel Schlereth used to be here. And Mark still follows the Tigers. And, you know, once you're a Tiger, I think, it never gets out of your system.
Well, there's something to culture, right? In the old English D and the history, it's a lot like the Yankees.
Yeah.
You know, Sox, the Cubs. Yeah. You know, like, there's that history to it. I mean, you know, Ty Cobb, you look and see a guy with no number. You know what I mean? That tells you back, and you hear different things. But I think that's we have beauty of Comerica Park. You look at the statues. You look at the Tiger out front. There's history that has come through there, and the guys should be prideful because, you know, they're not where they want to be. It's been a tough road to leg. There's nothing much positive. So enjoy the positive moments. I thought the positive moments would be Miggy's records this year, but this is definitely an added bonus. And this is why you love it, because you see how excited this young team, the pitchers, everybody was for this guy, from the pitchers to the outfield catcher or the third catcher. This meant a lot because of the resilience and because of Spencer Turnbull, the person also. He's an easy guy to root for.
These guys are starting to show up, man. Casey Mize a couple nights ago, three hitter, goes 7 2/3, strikes out 7. Hey, he struck out 9 last night, only walked 2. One hit was in, you know, one of them was in the ninth.
You know what it is when you want to get in a groove and you look at, here's the thing, and they're not to this level, but maybe they could be. You look at what the Atlanta Braves had back in the day, and John Smoltz, Steve Avery, Tom Glavine. You have a run where they push each other, right, where they push each other. Mize comes out, and then Turnbull comes out and one-ups them in that way. Now it's, you know, you don't expect that out of Scooble, but you expect a quality. If you get a quality start,
he's supposed to be the best of all of them.
I understand, and it takes time to develop these pitchers, but hopefully they push each other, and it looks like the camaraderie's there. So I like watching them. They're easy to cheer for.
That's the big thing. I was going to say the camaraderie's there, and they're having a good time playing.
Here,
that's
show,
the most important
show of
thing.
Hands. Who actually watched or listened to it live last night?
Parts of it.
I got through six innings.
I couldn't get through all of it.
And
yeah,
I petered out.
I mean, the end.
The doubleheader
Eazy,
killed
me. Did you
see
the end? Fish, you see the end?
I did not see the end. I was sleeping.
Well, I did. It was awesome.
I'm so you don't know how mad I was when I woke up and found that. I was happy, yet mad, when I woke up and I saw he had his no-hitter. Because I went to bed. I looked at it. I'm like, okay.
I wonder anybody out there, because if
there's
you're
no
like
hits.
Me, I was watching different things, and it came over my phone that through seven, he was scoring. So I turned it on for the eighth, and he got through the eighth, and then I flipped it back to watch the end. And it was nerve-wracking a little bit because you saw him walk a guy, sort of get away. But the way he bared down at the end and to hear him say is that I just geared back and threw as hard as I could whatever I had left, and it worked out.
To end it on a strikeout is something.
Yeah.
Truly something.
Well, that just puts that, you know, sometimes it's not going to cheapen it if it was a fly ball out, but it just sort of adds a little cherry on top.
I'm reaching out to Dan. Dan's going to be ready in a couple of seconds.
We just had a social media comment go up that said, how can you not be romantic about baseball? You know what? I'm starting to understand that more, because at the beginning of our season, I was like, oh my gosh, this is going to be such a fun season to watch. And then it was like, oh my gosh, this is what I have to watch. And now it's starting to get fun again. Like, there's starting to become like hope and just... You know what I mean?
You're
they're starting to play good.
Easy to please. There,
well, but
Pilar,
I'm just saying,
that,
like,
but it gives you hope.
It's easy to be. How can you not be romantic about it? Like, I get it. Like, romance is kind of one of those things where it's like, oh my God, this is so great.
Well, think,
oh,
think
boo.
About yesterday.
Oh my God, this is so great.
Our conversation yesterday with Dan Miller.
Which
right where he said, "What does every fan base want in any sport? Hope."
Right.
What did that give us last
it
night?
Was great.
More hope than we had, and nobody's bitching about Avila today.
No, they're not. And you know, I'm kind of happy about it. I'm very happy about it. I mean,
They're out of the basement.
They're, who knows, maybe they even keep moving up. We'll see. They play the Royals
play
next. Royals aren't anything big. They play three with the Royals, then they come home. So let's see what happens.
Yeah.
They play hard for each other. That's all that matters.
That's right. Oh, man. All right. Eazy, were you going to say something?
Sorry, we got Dan Dickerson ready too. So.
Oh, perfect. All right. Well, let's bring him on. Dan Dickerson, welcome to the Hook.
Live from Seattle. Danny's on the road again now. Thanks, buddy.
finally got this to happen. We in Chicago are the two first to travel, and it's I can't imagine having called that from like a dark Comerica park at 1 a.m. yesterday. So, pretty amazing that this all worked out.
I was thinking to you last night, this morning, and I'm like, oh, man, do I call him right now? Because I forgot that you were in Seattle, to be perfectly honest with you. And we used your call today. We love it, obviously. We love what you and Jim do, and that's the call we use. But, Dan, you've called a few in the past. How does this one rank?
It was just I think I just enjoyed it because Spencer Turnbull's been working so hard on, you know, He drifts a little bit of concentration. They want him to throw more strikes. The stuff has always been elite level, and it's just him putting it together, and it all came together last night. So I loved it. I loved watching it. You know, I've called two with Justin Verlander. You were never surprised when Justin Verlander threw a no-hitter, right? I mean, there were the times when he'd give up that first hit of the game and the crowd would groan when he was at his peak. That's how much you knew he could dominate and throw one any night. But Spencer Turnbull, he had the stuff to do it, but it's just a matter of would he put it all together. And the last two starts have been outstanding. And I said going in, this is a pretty good matchup for him. Really, let's face it, it's a pretty good matchup for almost any pitcher with stuff. It's not a very good lineup, but the fact that he put it together and he'd never pitched more than seven innings in a game in his first career complete game as a no-hitter, pretty cool.
Now, I know I've traveled with you in the past and, of course, come down to for Grapefruit League play, and you're so nice to open your home to me. But I'm thinking that it's looking like getaway day in that hotel room, Dan. I don't think you made your bed the way you usually do.
No, it's made. There's just a little bit of a little corner of the sheet there that has to go back on top. But
Go ahead, Pilar. I just had to dig him on housekeeping.
You're so wrong. You're so wrong. You know what? It's great to see people traveling again and calling in from hotel rooms. You know, I mean, that's a good sign that things are returning to normal. But, Dan, you know, the Tigers are pretty fun to watch right now. Where do you see us going from here?
I think some of the things that have happened in the last week are, you know, they've kind of shored up the defense. Up the middle defense is always important, right? It's been a struggle with Willie Castro at second base. Last 2 days, Jonathan Scope has been there. And this is a delicate balancing act for manager A.J. Hinch right now. They still want to develop Willie Castro. They're not giving up on him. But Jonathan Scope at second base the last two nights has been a great reminder of just how important it is to have rock solid, above average defense at second base, turning double plays, making plays that a lot of guys don't make. That bat needs to heat up, and it is, but Jonathan Scope at second has helped a lot. The two young catchers, both Haas and Rogers behind the plate, more athletic. They're just more energetic. I don't know, they call a good game, a big upgrade at catcher. And Grayson Grinner does a good job. I think both these guys have shown what the upside can be behind the plate. And Eric Haas obviously can hit a little bit too. So I think those two things have helped the defense. You've got a pitching staff that you've got three ground ball guys. And you want that rock solid defense. It has not been good for the last month or so. So I think those are little developments that are helping this staff. And right now the starting rotation is leading this team as the offense begins to heat up enough to certainly show that it can be better than the offense we saw for the preceding 3 weeks. It's been 2 weeks now where the offense has put together some pretty good games where usually they're putting together rallies with singles, walks, doubles, not a lot of home run power. Here in Seattle, surprisingly, it's been four home runs in two games that have really led the way. So I just see some good things going on. The bullpen is next. You know, that's a work in progress. They need help there. They need guys to really step up to levels that I know we've seen in the past. And I think it's going to get there, but to have a good rotation with a better defense, that's not a bad way to start when you're talking about turning things around.
You know what, Dan Dickerson, the voice, radio voice of the Detroit Tigers, and you mentioned Eric Haas, Divine Child, Dearborn, obviously hometown product. What I was most impressed with, and I gave it a 9.5 out of 10, but was that final strikeout, the mass toss, and the embrace right there. Not only showed me, I was like, these guys practiced this before or whatever, but you know, but the genuine pileup, and then the to ensue the celebration after the cream in the face, and then even guys coming out after. What does this do? Because you're around this now that you're traveling, but even at home, you're around this locker room. These guys look like they are having fun and they play hard for each other. You know, just what did you think?
I agree. Where,
on the Dickerson scale, what was that catcher, pitcher, you know, were you impressed as I was?
I was. I love the reaction. I mean, every single teammate. Not only after the little mob scene, you know, the every teammate got a hug. And I just think that shows everybody knows how good he is. He's a good guy. He works very hard. And they know that it's been a process to get to where he is. What I see is a team, yes, coming together. And I see a coaching staff that just stays very steady in their day-to-day emphasis of these are the things we need to do to play winning baseball. We have to, you know, think about, we have to raise our level of performance, but this is how we're going to get there. And Spencer Turnbull's a great example of that. The hitting in the last 2 weeks is a good example of that. That was an awful 17-game stretch where they didn't even average two runs a game. They just stayed with it. It's like, okay, but we're going to keep preparing the same way, but you guys, you have to take this into the game and apply it and understand what we're talking about when we talk about plate discipline and approaches and game plans that you can't cover everything. You have to look in a certain zone. You have to look for a certain pitch until you get to two strikes and then you battle. And we've seen improvements in all those areas. Plate discipline, two strike approaches. But the strike throwing for pitchers, I think, is leading the way. Boyd, Turnbull, Mize, all much better with their strike throwing compared to a year ago. Getting ahead, finding out that contact's okay. And now we're seeing guys work consistently into the sixth inning and beyond. Casey Mize doesn't get the eighth inning the other day unless he had a low pitch count. And he's understanding that he's got the stuff to fill up the strike zone, get the early count contact that A.J. Hinch talks about all the time, not be afraid of it. There's going to be some hard contact, but it's a lot of ground balls. And then that allows you to get into the seventh and eighth. They're trying to build these guys up to be guys who work deep into games, not 5 and 6 inning starters. They want them to work deep. They're figuring it out, and it's a lot of fun to watch the process.
Hey, Danny, 5 no-hitters already this year. Seattle's gotten behind 2 of them. Cleveland's behind 2 of them. And I thought there was another one, obviously, but you disagree with me. I think Madison Bumgarner should have had one, but it's 7 innings. That's okay. I'll pass on that right now. We won't get into that right now. But why all these no-hitters all of a sudden?
Well, league's hitting, what, 233 through the beginning part of May. I haven't looked lately, but I think it might be up to, what, 235?
Yeah. What's up?
It's the strikeouts. I mean, the strikeouts certainly are leading the way. Batting average on balls in play are lower, and that certainly suggests the shifting is probably part of the equation. Taking some of those batted balls, you know, out of play, and singles are being gobbled up by the shift. Teams continue to shift a ton. Tigers shift on almost every batter, certainly all the left-handed batters. So I think that's a big part of it. It's kind of a lot of different things. I think, you know, some of the Tigers believe it's hitters still selling out for home runs, and they remain very vulnerable to this pitch at the upper part of the strike zone. More and more teams are spinning it. The 50-50 split between fastballs and secondary pitches, that's been a 10-year trend. So there's a lot of factors involved, but I think it's really many things. But when you think about the strikeouts and how many fewer balls are being put in play, that's definitely going to affect batting average, and I think that's a big part of it.
All right, I got to get off just for a second. I know you got to run a little bit. Shohei Ohtani, the unicorn out in Anaheim. 14 home runs, leads the league, 2.10 ERA. He pitches tonight. I'm expecting a no-hitter.
he has to get the walks under control, and he did in his last start. He's a show. Isn't he?
Yeah.
This kid's unbelievable. He's unbelievable right now.
I've never
seen
anything like it. He's Babe Ruth.
I mean, last I looked, let's see, 9 walks, 48 strikeouts as a hitter with 14 home runs. So clearly he won't walk and strike out a lot, and yet he's got 14 home runs and 155 at-bats. He was walking a batter an inning until his last start. Then again, he had a good start. The stuff is, as you've seen, amazing. That 2.10 ERA, I think, is a little bit artificially low, but I just love any update I get on Shohei Ohtani. He's phenomenal. Two-way player in this day and age.
He hit the batter's eye. The batter's eye.
Oh, the power is unbelievable. The power is unbelievable. I love it. I love everything he's doing. I love that he's going both ways. I thought maybe when he came back from Tommy John, he wouldn't. Love it. It's a lot of fun to watch. I'd love to see him in person more often, but what a show.
Mm-hmm. No, that's awesome. One last thing from me, Dan, because Tarek Skubal on the mound tonight obviously has struggled. What are we looking for as fans to consider this a successful start? Does he need a quality start? They're looking to keep the runs down.
Hitter.
How can he keep this role going that the pitchers in front of him have done?
I think I'm kind of thinking the return to Seattle where he went to college. I mean, here's a kid from Nowheresville, Arizona, who ends up in Seattle because it's the only Division I program that offered him anything. But it was a key piece in his development. The Tommy John surgery is the only reason he fell to the 9th round. So I think he's probably got a little extra in him tonight because he's kind of not back home, but he's where he went to school. And I think that he's going to have some fans here from Seattle University that are going to be pouring for him. I think the biggest thing is what he did 2 starts ago, which is basically scrap the splitter and go back to the changeup. And just long story short, AJ Hinch said it makes you, when you throw a splitter, you're kind of leading with your wrist. When you throw the changeup, you're finishing out here. And that finish allows you, or makes you really, when you throw your fastball, finish better. We had not seen the good electric fastball since he scrapped the splitter and gone back to the changeup, the grip that he used at Double A. We have seen more life on that fastball at all speeds. It rides through the strike zone. And what I would look for tonight, I would look for, because even though there was hard contact last time out, he finished strong. I think he's learning kind of like a little maybe behind Turnbull and Mize, learning how to piece it together, understand how to get contact early in the count, have a pitch count that's low because his strike throwing hasn't been as good as the other guys, and start to throw more first pitch strikes, see the benefits of it. But I think the whole key is that fastball life is back. The next key, get the slider back because it's been inconsistent. And when it's right, he becomes a walk-out pitcher.
I know you got to check out now, Dan. So last Lions question for you. I got to get it in. Panay Sewell signs today. They give their number one pick, $24.1 million, 15 guaranteed. So the Lions are 5.5 in Vegas, the over-under for wins. What is your Lions thoughts for the year? I know you're a huge fan.
Over. Take your horn, believe me.
Look at Dan. He's trying to get his arm ready. Coach, you need my arm. You can use it for the Super Bowl. Keep playing that, Dan Dickerson, Dan, I tell you.
Thanks, brother. Thanks for coming on. Have a great call today.
Yeah, travel safe.
All right, guys, you're the best. Thank you.
Hey, you go to Safeco tonight. That's your favorite park. I think Kauffman is your second favorite. They go to the Royals.
Yeah, these are two. These are absolutely two of my favorite. Fenway and Seattle and Minnesota are probably my top three. But I do love KC for, that's a 70s era construction, which was a bad era for ballpark construction. They've done a great job there. I love going to KC.
All right, Dan. Have a safe trip. Continue traveling.
All right, guys.
Travel safe. Thanks.
Take care.
Go Tigers. Bye.
Go Tigers.
Yes.
Dan Dickerson, Fish, radio voice.
What do you have for us?
Maz, I'm with you. I wish it was Safeco Park. It's actually T-Mobile Park.
Oh, they changed it?
They changed it, yeah.
Damn it. I'm always saying that they're at Safeco. Yep. Not that Safeco is that's a drugstore. I mean, but at least it was we knew it was Safeco, but
yep.
It's T-Mobile?
Every 7 seconds sponsors Ruin Stadium.
Fish, that was so... Sucks, the man. Way you did that was so loving and just said, Maz, yeah. I wish it was, but it's not.
No, because I wish, too. I don't like them changing these names every 10 seconds.
Well, yeah, that's how I felt like
when
Laguna...
Soon Ford Field's going to be Little Caesars Field, right. Better yeah. Made Field.
Laguna Seca, when they changed their name, I was like, what, Weather Tech? Like, oh, man,
look, there's nothing worse than the White Sox Park. It used to be Comiskey. Now it's Guaranteed Rate Field.
Well, it used to be U.S. Cellular. That was fine.
I know, but that was bad, too. But
oh, you
it
didn't
was
like
Comiskey.
That one?
No, it's Comiskey Park. That's what it should be called. And, of course, the Mariners played at the Kingdom
what
when they first
the
were born.
What was the sign in left field when Hank Aaron broke Babe Ruth's
exactly.
record?
Bank America.
Eazy?
Is this coming from the guy who does the MyBookie update?
Yes.
You know how these things go, Maz.
I know.
I know
how it goes. I know how it goes.
It's all about the sponsorship.
It is what it is, right? I remember I watched hockey when there was nothing on the dasher boards either. So, we can keep going if you really want to go.
Right. All right, guys. Big thanks to Dan Dickerson for joining us here on The Hook. When we come back, let's talk Panay Sewell signing his fat contract. And what we're going to expect from him this year. And also, we're going to talk a little bit more about the Lions being the underdog. What?
A lot.
A lot. Come on, guys.
A
what?
Lot, a
seriously?
Lot.
Who's doing
can't
these
be
articles?
Really much
what are
more
they
than
smoking?
That.
I mean, come
hey,
on.
Hey, Stick said they're, well, let's face it, they. Vegas has them going winless. We'll tell you about it.
We'll tell you all about it. So don't go anywhere. You're tuning into The Hook on Woodward Sports Network.
Hi, I'm David Hall from Hall Financial. And at Hall Financial, we treat our clients like family. And our number one priority is giving each of our clients five-star service. Our passion for five-star service, combined with our expertise, allows us to find the best possible solution for refinancing your home loan. We take the time to focus on both the individual and the numbers. We're going to walk you through the process and close your loan in half the time of our competition. Go to DavidHallMortgage.com today.
Hey guys, D-Mac here. Don't tell me what, tell me who. 8 Mile Vodka, that's the who of Detroit. 8 Mile Vodka, born in Detroit, distilled in single 90-liter batches to allow for optimal quality control and care. Carbon-filtered, aerated bottle at the perfect time to produce a subtle taste and smooth finish and a character all its own. If you care about it, I hear it's damn good. They actually just won an award. This is an exceptional premium vodka that can be chilled, enjoyed straight, mixed, or create an exceptional cocktail. Myers. Your local bars, ask for 8 Mile Vodka, but if you do, please, 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 like Pilar says, don't get shit-faced unless you're in your own house. drink responsibly. Sorry, she says
there
that
you go.
Too.
Welcome back to The Hook on Woodward.
Or get shit-faced. Or get shit-faced in your own house.
In your own house, as we said, yep. Unless you're in your own house.
Yeah, get shit-faced
don't
in your own
crazy.
House.
Don't get crazy.
You're always about home drinking, Pilar. Whatever it is, it always comes up. It's
easier. I would say it's easier. You're not worried about drinking and driving. You're not worried about somebody else hitting you that's been drinking and driving. You're not, just
It's responsible
stumble home,
part.
Right?
It's
you're like right there.
You're a responsible madre.
Yeah, there we go. That's what I'm talking about. All right, guys. So Penei Sewell signs his contract, 4 years, $21.4 million. 14.88 of that was in the signing bonus.
That's nice.
It sure is, right?
That would be really nice to have.
Four years.
But just break it down and think about it, because everything we've learned about him, obviously coming, you know, the work ethic
off of
the Samoa, the Isle, but for his family, and, you know, we saw them draft night. I know the feeling, not to that level, but to be able to afford your loved ones, you know, things that they couldn't before have, it's such a fulfilling, you know, to your journey. It's all part of the journey. And I know for him, whatever he does for his parents or his siblings or his community, it's heartfelt. And that's not because he has to, because he wants to. So he deserves it. And he'll, I mean, it's work ethic. So now the fact that he's got it, doesn't have to worry about it. Now he can go to work.
Yep. There you go. Exactly. Now he can just go to work, do his job. But I mean, that's real money for a young kid. I mean, we saw Mikey,
no real money for an old kid.
Yeah, absolutely. But I mean, that's, you know, you're walking into almost $15 million when you're in your early 20s. Just to put it into perspective, Mikey TikTok was in here helping us write our board, and he's writing and he goes, wow, $15 million and he's my age.
Like, yeah. Mikey,
you start
lied.
To think
he's
that.
Older
I mean,
than Mikey.
He's...
You're not that old, Michael. Michael, social media with your glasses on. But the thing, it's about, and it goes back to who you're surrounded by.
That's the most
not
important thing.
Not only the
thing.
Organization, but the people to are just surrounded to succeed. I mean, thank goodness I wasn't that good. That would have been ugly. You know, back in the day. I mean, I would have needed to make that on my last year to be able to appreciate. All right, if somebody wants to give me $15 million right now, I mean, we're all good. I think I know what I'd do with it. So it's, but again, you know, it's life lessons. He's earned it. Yeah. The hard work come
for
that
sure.
way. It goes to show you what these top draft picks get. What is, Maz, do you know off the top of your head, like, how different would this be from Trevor Lawrence's first overall? Is it like half or?
Oh, man, that's a good question.
Yeah,
I'll look it up.
Like,
I don't know.
Lawrence?
I just bring it up because I read something compared to
the number one pick versus the number seven pick.
But the last year's and where the money, somebody said it's comparable because this guy got this and whatever. So, I mean, it's life-changing money. Don't get me wrong. But, and if you can find the right piece to your puzzle, so. You know, we'll see. But it'd be interesting to see what Trevor Lawrence, if he hasn't signed or...
Maybe Vegas will change those lines now.
Just off of a quick Google search, it says almost $37 million the value of the contract that Trevor Lawrence will eventually sign with the Jags.
I think it's like the NHL where it's pretty much
slotted
in.
Yeah, with a signing bonus of $24 million.
But slotted in with a lot better money than the NHL.
Yeah.
Because remember we were talking about... the receivers. You're getting a receiver at number seven. He's getting $24 million for that 4 years.
Right.
Instead of signing, who'd we lose again?
Kenny Golladay.
Yeah, Kenny Golladay wanted, what, $18 million per year?
Yeah.
Right.
So, you know, it's a big difference.
Yeah.
Those teams that got those number one draft pick wide receivers, like Cincinnati, that's all they're paying out. They're paying out just $25, $26 million
right.
for these kids.
Eazy, what do you have for us?
I want to say Jalen Waddle. I don't know if you guys saw this. His contract's fully guaranteed.
So's Penei's.
Penei's
so's,
fully guaranteed too?
Yes,
that's awesome.
Fully guaranteed.
That's amazing.
And I think that's more to the – that's coming to be something newer. And but you, to your point, that's over the four-year deal they're making,
right.
The 24, right?
Right?
So,
correct.
But it's a guaranteed contract up front. So again, Maz, that's a great point, because in any sport – when you're bringing in the capologist, bringing in the salary cap, you're bringing in.
Why keep this guy when you can get this
guy?
Right, exactly. Yeah. And the money, sometimes that the money will go into the decision. Why didn't you pick him? He was a better player. And you don't realize that the GM's going, yeah, but $5 million here helps me here. So that's things that we don't see.
Yeah.
And that's how the Lions.
Way above my pay grade.
That's how the Lions are underdog in every single game this year.
I like that.
In Vegas, from Westgate, Las Vegas.
Good.
Every single game. Come on, guys.
Even against the Bengals.
Be.
I like your shirt, Mac.
Good. Well, the Bengals, they might be, but they're gonna be a team nobody wants to play. And you know what? That'll probably, whether it changes or not, I think that's a great situation for a first-year head coach, first-year GM, first-year with what the guys sort of, if I refer to them as the ex-players coaching staff team, right, to get their feet wet. So the expectations... you know, they have a year to set this foundation down of how they're going to play. So they play hard to the end of the game, whistle to whistle. They don't do stupid things, right? We can get on board. And there'll be money to be made on the line side if they're plus money.
Hey, yeah, I'm going to give you a game. We know San Francisco, they're a 7-point underdog.
San Fran.
Okay. Yeah, San Francisco. Exactly. Now, can they play at Green Bay on a Monday Night Football? That game is off the board because we don't know about Aaron Rodgers. Let's say Aaron Rodgers stays there. They will be at least a 6-point underdog in that game to the Packers.
I'd say 8.
Maybe. Then they're home for Baltimore. They're going to be a home dog against the Ravens. Ravens are very good. But that's probably a 4-6-point spread as well. And you can go on. I'm going to give you a game now. How about Philadelphia, week 8, right before the bye week at Ford Field? What number would you put on that game?
3.5.
Yeah. That's about right. Eagles will be favored by about a field goal.
Wow.
Yeah.
I have the Eagles winning that game. They're coming off of a game.
Can you bet the games now?
I think you could.
The Rams, yeah. And if you do, you bet them at what they are like now.
Yeah, yeah. No. I mean, yeah, I'd be betting on.
Yeah, you lock it in.
I'd be betting on the Lions.
You tried to bet week 1 when you thought the Lions were favored by 7.
I did. The first thing I did was go to the
office. Lions favored by 7.
Before I tell Maz, before I report it, I got to make sure. Is this right? Yeah. Can I get money in on this? I got money. But we're always looking for stuff like that. But again, when you're talking about that, if the league numbers are out, you look at the schedule. I think I mentioned it. You look at Cleveland's schedule compared to like Baltimore. So if where they play Cleveland, Pittsburgh, you know, Cleveland again, where there's a bye week in there, that's where the bye weeks and the really good bettors sort of can figure out where it happens. I'm sure it's the same way in fantasy,
it
too,
is,
right?
100%.
Like you mentioned yesterday.
That's what I'm saying. Like if you look at their schedule, week 7, they're playing the Rams. They're either going to come off of a really high ego-boosting, hey, we just beat the Rams, or a completely deflated, oh, my God, we just got our ass handed to us by the Rams. So going against Philly that next week right before a bye, I see them either way giving every single thing that they got. They're going to leave it all on the field more than any other game because – either they're going to come in high or they're going to come in low, but they're going to go into a bye week following.
Would you say Philly game, Maz, would be the first one maybe that you look at to be half confident with what Pilar's saying? No, I'm just saying, like, which games do you look at?
Bengals. I look at the Bengals. I look at us possibly being 0-5 going into the Bengals in week 6.
No way. See, I think that the problem with the Bengals is that by week 6, they're going to be so banged up.
Well.
The Bengals' MO. It's a story of the Bengals. I have us beating the Bengals.
Yeah, but they drafted the offensive tackle. Oh, we got him.
Yeah.
But Joe Burrow is on schedule
they
to
got
start
their
week
shiny.
One, by the way.
He's scheduled to start.
Yeah.
But we don't – I mean, they didn't get him any protection or insurance for his knee.
Well, they might have done that later in the draft. We'd have to look at their draft. I'm pretty sure they drafted a couple offensive linemen.
Yeah, you can draft a couple of offensive linemen, but did you draft – the best offensive lineman, right? I mean, did you get what you were supposed to get, and that's protection?
No, they got him his favorite wide receiver.
They got him his favorite wide receiver.
His buddy from LSU.
Exactly. And I'm not mad at that pick, trust me. I am not mad at that pick. That's what I wanted to happen so that we would get Sewell.
That Chicago game in Chicago could be interesting, too. You know,
week 4.
I have us beating Chicago.
Week 4, good weather. We get into good weather games, if you notice. At Green Bay early, at Chicago early.
Yeah.
Well, if I was a Lion, that's the first one I'd be looking to is Green Bay in Chicago. When do we play them? And if you're playing them, at least in the fall, you're winning.
Yeah.
It might be windy, but it's not cold.
Right. So.
Hey, you know, I read something also during the draft. If Penei Sewell was not there, they were going wide receiver with that pick.
I would imagine that to be true. I mean, who else are you going to grab?
I was hoping they would trade it, but they had a chance to trade it.
If you don't have the chance to trade it, if you don't have anybody, you know, offering
it all
a trade,
worked out
then
the end,
it did.
As I believe the way it was supposed to.
We'll see how it goes.
But I would see them going for a wide receiver at that point, or locking in maybe a quarterback of the future.
Right.
But it doesn't matter because we got Sewell. We got protection for our quarterback, and that's what we need.
Our 26th ranked quarterback.
I mean, you know what though?
Focus.
That's fine. That's fine.
Hey,
Everybody can expect nothing.
What about our running back?
Holy crow. We're going to get into all this.
Oh, yeah, mama. Don't
get me started.
Can I do a segue?
We'll do it next.
Our quarterback got disrespected for the Lions at 26,
wait till you see what PFF Pro Football Focus did to our running backs. Stay tuned.
Next. Exactly. Next. Don't go anywhere. You're tuning into The Hook on Woodward Sports Network. Hey friends, did you know that Sun RV Resorts has over 160 RV and camping resorts in the US and Canada? Well, guess what? They do, and you want to check this place out because guests can enjoy water parks, lazy rivers, miniature golf, restaurants, bars, and even Wi-Fi if they choose to stay connected, with locations from the Florida Keys to Myrtle Beach to San Diego Bay and Petoskey, Michigan. Guests can enjoy the outdoors at a Sun RV Resort. All right, everybody, welcome back to The Hook on Woodward Sports Network, Detroit's all-digital sports network, live from my bookie studios. It is Wednesday, May 19th, and Maz, kick off the second hour with your sports update.
I will. Brought to you by mybookie.ag. Use Woodward. They will match your first deposit up to $1,000, and Woodward 10 will get you a free $10 play on us. Give them a try. Tigers going for the sweep tonight in Seattle. Winners of 7 of 9, you heard Spencer Turnbull with that 8th no-hitter in Tigers history last night. A 5-0, 9-strikeout, 2-walk gem. The first one since JV did it in 2011. And Jamer Candelario saved them in the 7th inning with a great defensive play. And how about that catcher, Eric Haas? Let's just show you the cut anyway. Here's Dan Dickerson with the call.
Turnbull, 1 strike away from history. To the back of the mound, grabs the rosin bag, bounces it off the back of his hand one more time, and drops
it
to the ground.
Your favorite movie.
Climbs up the hill and settles in on the first base side of the rubber. Cabrera well off the line at first. The Tigers shift 3 to the left on Mitch Haniger, the best hitter in this Mariners lineup. Turnbull sets. The 0-2 pitch, swing and a miss.
Watch the
history.
Boom.
Spencer
Sick
Turnbull has become the 6th Tiger pitcher to throw the 8th no-hitter in franchise history. His teammates burst out of the dugout and mob him at the mound.
The way he tossed that mask.
I love that kid. I love Eric Haas. We were talking about him. I mean, congrats to Spencer Turnbull. Same two teams tonight. Let's see if Tarek Skubal can get in on all the fun. You know. We had Casey Mize 2 nights ago. You had Turnbull last night. It's Tarek Skubal's turn tonight from Seattle. Stay awake for that one. Shohei Ohtani, home run number 14. He pitches tonight against the Indians. Mike Trout out at least 2 months with a calf injury. And you heard Penei Sewell signing with the Lions. Guaranteed deal for $24.1 million, almost $15 million. Up front, NBA playoffs underway with the play-in games tonight. The West play-in game, Spurs and Grizzlies, that's the 9-10 from Memphis. And the 7-8 matchup is Lakers and Warriors. Draymond Green was bitching about the play-in series, but he's kind of changed his tune since then.
I'm excited as hell. I think, you know, playing against the Lakers, defending champion, with an opportunity to solidify our spot in the playoffs. The stage doesn't get any bigger in L.A. I've been very vocal about the play-in tournament. But this is great. I'm excited about this. This is a great opportunity for us.
I don't know if LeBron and AD and are as excited, but they get to play tonight, and it'll be in L.A. Last night, Pacers knocked off the Hornets. Hornets go home for the winter or the summer. Indiana plays the Wizards now for the 8th seed and a date with number 1 Philly. Washington lost last night to the Celtics, so Boston gets the number 2 seeded Nets. NHL Stanley Cup playoffs, full slate tonight. You got Game 3 of the Caps and Bruins from Boston. That series tied at 1. The Canes from the Predators from Carolina. That place will be packed. It'll be loud. The Caniacs, as Matt calls them. Carolina up 1-0. The Blues in Colorado. Avalanche leads at 1-0, and the Jets and Oilers from Edmonton, game number one there. Last night, Penguins a winner, Lightning win it, and Vegas win it. All those series tied at one. Nope, the Lightning are up 2-0. Let's take you to this day in sports. 2004, they go to the Western Conference Finals if they get a win. It's the 45th birthday today for Kevin Garnett, the big ticket. Check him out.
Christie and Bibby comprise those two positions for Sacramento.
Well, he just crossed over and left Chris Webber standing in his wake. Nobody on the weak side to help.
Is that Hoff on Hoff time?
Serbian.
This guy's got energy. He's going to need it all.
And Miller's got Garnett way outside. Oh, what a shot by Kevin Garnett!
Oh, man. 45 years young today. Does KG feel 45 to you, Mac?
No.
I mean, Pilar, anyone?
No.
45?
I don't know, Maz. I don't feel up. Kevin Garnett, see how I don't feel people up, see how old they are, but no.
I mean, I don't either, but I knew what you were saying, yeah. Okay?
Does he feel like, not feel up? He doesn't.
I knew what you were saying.
Yeah. By the way, Hall of Famer against Hall of Famer.
Matt Hoff on Hoff crime.
Yeah, Hoff on Hoff crime on early Hoff. In that one. That was Kevin Garnett running past Chris Webber, both, well, one going into Hall of Fame next year, one's already in. Who went in on Sunday night. Congratulations to those guys. I want to take you back to 1983, Mac. This one's for you. It's the Islanders. They just wrapped up their fourth Stanley Cup in a row. And we go to CBC for Hockey Night in Canada. Dave Hodge has got the interview with my man Billy Smith, the Islanders goalie, who was a son of a bitch. He really was. He would hit you with the stick.
I mean,
he, oh, my God. Anyway, he wins the Conn Smythe Trophy for best player in the playoffs. They're interviewing him. Check this unbiased interview out with Billy Smith.
It was shorter than anybody thought. It was this fellow right here, and that's why he deserved the trophy.
Okay, John, I know.
He took the game away from him.
I know you'd like to congratulate the other members of the Islanders. I want to just ask a couple of questions of Billy Smith. You mentioned you related to the controversy that you seemed to cause. Tell us about the major penalty to Anderson.
Well, I did the same thing that Gretzky did to me to draw five penalties out. When I hit Gretzky in Edmonton, he rolled around and cried like he was dying. So when he hit me tonight, I says, hey, I may just as well do the same thing. So that's what I did. I threw myself on my back and I squirmed. Incidentally, he got 5 minutes. So all I want to tell the people in Canada and all over the world, two can play that game.
Amazing!
You don't hear that anymore.
I love that.
You don't hear that.
Absolutely.
That's Billy Smith of the Islanders.
You know that Billy Smith has the... He is the first goalie that I ever shot on. Not the real Billy Smith. We had a shed. We had the shed in the back of our house, and I spray painted Billy Smith because it was Jurnis on it. And my dad, right, Craig McCarty gave me, because at the air conditioning we had the sheet metal, they made me a 5 pound, or maybe it was like 3.5 pound puck. Right, a little bit bigger. I tore that shed down by putting holes in it with this puck, shooting on Billy Smith.
Oh my
goodness. Till I got in trouble for it. Right? I knocked it down at least the bottom, but I had Billy Smith drawn on there and whatever, and I always loved him. And that is old school eye for an eye.
That's
how about
great.
Breaking Wayne Gretzky's balls?
Yeah.
I mean, he didn't care. Wayne Gretzky.
Yeah.
That's my game.
Right?
That's my league. That's my league. Yes. Billy Smith is my guy.
Mine too.
And I love how after he just comes out in the press conference and just says exactly what it was. It's not like now in the NBA and everything. It's like all these flops and it's a big deal. And everybody's like, no. It was really
I love
hurt.
That he addressed
like,
Canada.
You know,
and to everybody in Canada, two can play that game.
And he's got a can of Bud in his hands, which you didn't really saw, but he does have a can of Bud.
Oh, I didn't even realize
that. And John Ziegler, the most tan commissioner in history because he was never at any games for the NHL was there. John Ziegler could be the worst commissioner in all of sports history. But he always had the best hand.
Oh.
Always. He was always on vacation.
That was great.
How long? 83?
83. The following 84? Year is when they lost to the Oilers and Edmonton took it from there.
Well, Gretz got mad. You got called out, came back, and decided to put a streak together.
How about that? Canadians, dynasty. Yeah. Islanders, dynasty. Oilers, dynasty. Mm-hmm. All in a row.
Yep.
Amazing.
But who watches hockey?
All right, guys, let's shift our focus.
Know what's bad for you. They're good for you.
So Pro Football Focus has released their position rankings.
They
let's
suck.
Clearly they hate the Lions.
Maz, I'm sorry. Did we not? I didn't hear you say it, but I thought with Goff at 26th, like, we figured they sucked yesterday.
Yeah.
But now they don't even suck. I mean, poor Easy's looking for somebody to go after. He wants to, he's like, wants to fight not Bruce Lee anymore. He wants to fight PFF.
And I looked for someone at PFF. I'm trying to get them on the air with us because we need to ask
them.
We
need some
And they got Chris Collinsworth on the staff. They got football minds on the staff.
Yeah.
Who wrote the article?
It doesn't tell you. It's just the whole thing. It's Pro Football.
Oh, I looked it up. I got beef. It's Sam. I think his last name's Moron or something like that.
Sam.
I'll find it for sure. I swear. It's like Sam.
Send it to us. Yeah. Send it to us.
Keep him accountable. Yes.
So yesterday.
Please tell me why, right?
So
Give me your why.
Let's start with the quarterback.
That's why I want to ask this guy. Give me your why. What the heck? Like, this makes no sense to me.
Yesterday, we did the quarterbacks. We'll just redo them real quick for you. You had Mahomes, Brady, Rodgers, Wilson, Watson. And then all the way down to 11, you had Matthew Stafford. And then all the way down to 26, you had Jared Goff. And there's only 32 quarterbacks in the NFL. So there you go.
Hey, Maz, do you know who the ones he's better than?
Yes. He's allegedly better than Ryan Tannehill, Derek Carr, Kirk Cousins, Justin Herbert. I mean, Justin Herbert, I'm going to say, okay.
Wait, what?
Ben Roethlisberger, Kyler Murray. I mean, there's some. Joe Burrow?
No, how about the rookie? The kid that didn't
I'm saying
Justin
Ryan
Fields?
Fitzpatrick.
Go to Ryan Fitzpatrick. Go to who they think he's better than.
Daniel Jones.
So go to 27.
These are. Oh, who do
you
think better than?
Go to 27 and say, these are the guys, five guys that
he's better than.
I understood
the other way. So he's better than Cam Newton. He's better than Sam Darnold. He's better than Tua Time. He's better than Zach Wilson. He's better than Jalen Hurts.
Why is he better than Zach, but not as good as Justin Fields?
Because I don't know who wrote this. And he's better than Drew Locke.
All right. Now, if you went through playoff victories, stats or whatever, and you put it up, it's ridiculous. So, you know what? Again, it's like the Detroit Lions being underdogs in every game, good. That's the way I want the league so we can establish. This is the best thing for Jared Goff. The only thing he can do is go better. He can't, in my mind, when he's at his worst, he's still only 21st or 22nd in the league. You know what I'm saying? So it's ridiculous. And as far as Matt Stafford, with the way the schedule is, he has the opportunity to globally show if he can put it. If he can do it, and he could be up top five. Like, people could go nuts of seeing what he's seen with the talent he has in L.A. and stuff like that. So,
but I also want to point out, though, because it's like, if you look at just the rankings, like, it's insulting, and I can give you a million different reasons, like, why he's better than some of these quarterbacks. And who has campaigned for Ryan Fitzpatrick more than me?
Nobody.
I mean, nobody has. I love Ryan Fitzpatrick, but I'm not going to say that he is a better quarterback than Jared Goff. But if you read what they have to say, a lot of it is the coaching staff and the system that he's in and the schemes that they're going to put him in. So they're addressing the fact that, you know, the Lions organization are 100% going to have to put him in a position to excel. So it's not so much just Jared Goff alone. It's kind of the system that he's in. So this is a new system.
Easy. Did this guy do this? He had this in his computer from like 3 months ago, and he didn't go to the draft and realize that.
Oh, he went to the draft. He's got Fields in there.
That's what I'm saying, right? So what
he's got Travis Etienne
saying is they've addressed that with the left tackle, which will buy him at the minimum 0.2 more seconds of time, which is what he needs.
They still
more
had
than
a good line prior to Sewell. Prior to him.
That's what I'm saying.
They had a good one.
Yeah. Easy, what do you have?
And I apologize. Sam Monson was the guy. He did the running backs one that set me off yesterday. The guy who wrote this one's Bruce Gadowski. But Ben Roethlisberger is one of the guys that's on the list. I think he's a little bit past his peak. He's at the duck age, where that's kind of all he's throwing. Jared Goff saw better stats than him last year and played less games. And he's Ben Roethlisberger sitting at 16 on this list.
It's because he's here.
PFF staff.
It's because he's here.
Yeah, I think it's because he's here.
He's going to know now. He's going to know where he's at now because, let's face it, every time the Lions are on the clock, most drafts, they go to the commercial. I mean, no one gives a shit about the Lions. No one does except us. No one knows the pain except us.
I mean, two spots better at 24. They've got Jameis Winston / Taysom Hill from the New Orleans Saints. Come on. I mean, this is just – they're just putting it more in systems than what
systems typically
excel. Well,
let's not get overly upset about the one we thought we'd be overly upset about and get to the next one.
Let's go to running backs.
Yes, I think it's more upsetting – and
you know what? I'm going to let Eazy run these down.
Eazy's got to burr up his ass and the most out of this one.
Eazy, do the top six or seven and then, you know, kind of do what you do.
All right. I'll put I think we did the top seven. Number one, we have the top seven I can't really argue with, maybe Barkley.
Right.
But the thing is, this list goes 1 through 32, and the person they're missing, and what's driving me nuts, is there's backups and rookie backups. Rookie backups are being moved to wide receiver position. Mm-hmm. Ranked over DeAndre Swift, who just got a refrigerator placed on the right side of his offensive line. What the hell is going on here?
But DeAndre Swift, so obviously he's not even up there mentioned?
They only have
32.
Yes, there's no Lion in that 32. DeAndre Swift doesn't exist on this list. He does not exist.
D-back, there's backup rookies like Ntieni, which he does look sweet. I get, right? He's on Jacksonville, who just had the number one overall pick, and who also has another quarterback or running back.
Robinson.
And they're moving him to receiver.
But here's
what's going on?
Here's Maz's point. And this just puts the hammer on it, like Judge Judy and walking the Judge Judy walk off, is that there is no respect out there at all. Because this is the ultimate disrespect.
Yes.
And you know what? If we notice it, at least now, I think the people that are in Allen Park and running this organization, from Sheila Fordham down to Dan Campbell, Brad Holmes, the coaching staff, they know it too. They know it coming from other organizations, what's expected. Mark Brunell, quarterback's coach, the reason that he's here, the opportunity. It's about football, right? It's Dan Campbell to be able to work for him. It didn't take him long to make his decision because it's about football. So this is just all of this stuff we're hearing, it gets us upset as fans, but it's only fodder to the team that we have now. If this was happening with last year's regime, then you're spinning your tires and it means nothing because it's the same as where we've
been. I'm shocked they don't have Kerryon Johnson on here.
Yeah, I mean, Nick on our social media.
He's not on there, is he?
No.
Oh, my gosh. If that would have been the ultimate.
That would have been really, really it.
Nick on social media says, with the history of sophomore Lions running backs, I'm okay with that. He wasn't even on the list, though.
Nothing.
I mean, he's got to do.
He was the number one running back last year on the list. Or two in every draft room. One or two. And you know what? He didn't impress the hell out of me last year. I'll be the first to tell you that. But he's top 32 without a question.
Yes.
Without a question.
I mean, coupled with the draft.
Lion eyes. Sewell, it's like mayonnaise, but it's lion eyes.
He's not splitting carries anymore with Adrian Peterson. I'm assuming he's taking a lead back role. Jamal Williams probably getting third down and stuff like that.
Surprise, AP's not in there.
Yeah. The way they have Tony Pollard at 21, the backup for
Dallas.
This
is crazy.
They got Zeke at like 12, Ezekiel Elliott.
This is crazy.
He had a terrible year last year.
He's supposed to be. With the contract he's supposed to be top 12.
No, he's supposed to be top 5.
That's
what I meant. I mean, he's fallen from grace. This is a huge backup.
You look at the top 5. They're pretty good.
Are you picking him, Pilar? If you have a running back,
it depends where I am in my draft.
Second round.
You're in your house.
If he's in the second round.
You're in your office.
He fell to the second round. No one's taking him in the first round.
End of the second, I'll probably take him. It depends, like, where you are.
I mean, he wasn't going to slip out of the first round the first 3 years that he was in the league. No. Now he's starting to slip.
Dak is back. Dak being back has a lot to do with his success. So, I'm taking him in the second
round. Now, wide receivers, that's another story. You know, we don't really have anybody here. We traded away our best wide receiver, let him go, I mean, as a free agent. So let's go to the wide receivers now. And we start with Davante Adams.
Understandable.
DeAndre Hopkins.
Agreed.
Tyreek Hill.
Mm-hmm.
This one I don't get. I don't get Allen Robinson. I don't get him. I personally,
really?
I don't see it.
He's good. So but the top, thing with, he might be top 10, but I don't see him four.
I don't see
well,
him
the prob-
four.
The problem with Allen Robinson is he's going to have a new quarterback, which is,
yeah, again.
It's the big thing, right? Again.
I know he's never had anybody really to throw to him, but how is he four?
Well, when he was very successful.
Hey, look at how different Devontae Adams would be if Blake Bortles is throwing to
good
him.
Good point.
Yeah.
He'd probably be 11th.
But no. I mean, he's had success. He's a very, very talented wide receiver. I don't know if I would put him this high in the list, considering he's got a new quarterback. And Julio, we don't really know who his quarterback is going to be yet. They still need to iron that out, too.
Julio Jones is next. And then A.J. Brown, I don't believe he should be there. And then Michael Thomas after him. So there's your wide receivers. No Lions in sight. Not that they should be. Hopefully they will be this year. Hopefully St. Brown will be in there by the time the year's up. I'm on St. Brown, right? Why not?
Somebody,
he
why
said
not?
He's gonna, he said someone's going to lose their job on a Lions.
Yes,
that,
Ryan
that's his
is
goal.
Absolutely right.
PFF should lose their job based on a Lions.
Ryan on our social media is absolutely right. He said, Allen Robinson is great in garbage time fantasy fantasy points. 100%.
Allen Robinson, nothing.
All right, so then we're going to go to tight ends.
Why not?
All right.
Where's the Hawk?
I mean, this. I'm not mad at... At least he made the top 10.
Yes.
He better.
Yeah.
There's some good ones up there. But
I do feel he could go a little bit better.
You could scratch your head on Dallas Goedert. You got Travis Kelce.
That's what I was going to say. You got
George Kittle. Waller, who was, I think, probably the best one. Darren Waller from Oakland.
Imagine hearing Rodgers throwing to Waller.
From Vegas, excuse me. And then you got the new kid. Pitts from Atlanta. Kyle Pitts, the rookie. Dallas Goedert, which I don't get that he's there. He's Philadelphia, but he's the number one guy there now. And you got Mark Andrews. You like Mark Andrews.
Yeah, he's phenomenal. I mean, especially in fantasy. He's
Lamar
Jackson's
go-to guy. Yep, and then you got the Hawk at 7. Top 7 for sure. At least we got one there.
And I think that this year he moves up. I think this year he'll be at top 5. We heard
he's got,
Dan
yeah,
Miller
he get,
say,
that's
yes,
a tight,
that's
you know,
his,
when you're looking at tight ends,
Goff's shiny
those
weapon.
Top four, well, with what they say Pitts will be, but yeah, I'd be happy if he moved up.
Yeah.
He's got the ability to.
From what everyone is saying, Kyle Pitts will probably be number one on this list when
I
it's
bet.
All said and done. We'll see how Matt Ryan does and Julio Jones and picks up the pieces.
It's going to be a monster
Kittle
here.
Kittle and Kelce
for...
got something to say about that.
Yeah.
Well, but here's the thing with Kyle Pitts is the situation that he's in. One, he's got a quarterback that can 100% sling the ball every single game. His arm does not get tired. He's been doing it for the last several years. That's just because their defense is so crappy that they have to air the ball out every single game. But two, you're on a team that's got Julio Jones, who's always going to be double covered, which is going to give him a lot more opportunity to be able to get the ball. So
Brian's laughing at me because I picked Waller over Kelce. You know, it's negligible. They're all terrific receivers. They're all
incredible,
terrific tight ends.
Yep.
Waller's one of the best.
Yeah.
If not
George Kittle is phenomenal. I just hate his quarterbacks.
Yeah.
I mean, that's...
Well, we'll find out, right? We'll
Unless
see how Trey Lance
Aaron
does.
Rodgers.
See how Trey Lance does with them.
Yeah.
And that takes us to our teams. They have the team ranking. And, Mac, I'm going to let you take this one. Start off with the number one team, which there aren't going to be any arguments for the 1-2 punch here.
Yeah, they got the Chiefs over the Bucks, eh?
Yep.
Chiefs, Bucks, Bills, Packers there, I'm assuming, with their
with
thinking
Aaron Rodgers
being back. Ravens, 5. I don't know there. But they're good, but still the question is Lamar Jackson. 6, the Rams. 7, the Saints. And, guys, guess who's number 9? I don't know. Not the Lions. Lions are 32. Right where we want to be. Right
Dead
where we want to be.
Last.
Dead
yes,
last.
When
Can
you're
I
last and you're at the bottom,
people?
Then the kneecaps are closer to the ground to bite them. And you can start biting them, and then you hinder your opponents, and they, they're going to overestimate
us. Look at the Houston Texans. How can anybody be worse than the freaking Houston Texans?
Who knows what's going to happen with their
last year, so? They had a quarterback. They don't have a quarterback this year. We don't even know if their quarterback's going to play. Who the hell is going to be playing quarterback for them?
Nobody knows.
I mean, but they're still signing people. Nobody knows. Who are they going to be throwing to? They don't really have any big studs out there. No. Let's talk about their defense. J.J. Watt is gone. How can anybody be worse than the Houston Texans. And I'm from Texas. I want nothing but all Cowboys of our Texans. Fans,
so that's
I understand
really
that,
like,
but
that's really Houston, like a Michigan, somebody saying something nice about Michigan State. Doesn't
no,
count.
But Houston is so close to San Antonio. We root for them. I want nothing but great things for all of
did
the Texans.
Did you root for the Oilers when
I
you
did.
Were a little girl?
I was just a baby,
love
though.
Love the
but,
Oilers.
Yeah.
Love you, Blue.
Did they come in the league, Maz? 85?
Love you, Blue.
So I was just, but I did have their T-shirts.
Remember what they called the Mac? I'm going to give you a test here. What did they call the Astrodome when the Oilers were in there, with Jerry Glanville running them? It was a nickname.
I don't know.
The House of Pain.
Oh, that was the House of Pain.
The House of Pain was the Astrodome.
Oh, that was it.
When the Oilers played there. So, yep. Yeah. So they got the Lions dead last at 32. Why not? 5.5 is the over/under. And we are underdogs in every single game. The Lions are not us. I don't play on a team. But it is my one of my favorite teams. So, yes.
It's us.
It is
us. You're talking about our team.
It's Pro Football Focus. Go on there.
What
if you want to give them a follow and bust their chops online, go for it, man.
Don't follow. Pro
what
Football
did
Fluke.
Terrell Owens go on primetime television crying about. That's my quarterback you're talking about, man. That's
yeah. right.
Quarterback.
Do you guys think the Saints ranking's kind of weird, too? Like, given, like, we don't even know. I'm assuming it's Jameis, right? But, like, Jameis had a horrible year
yes.
last time he was a starting quarterback.
Put it this way.
And you have them in the
I
top
would
10.
Not be betting
they're
all
gonna
these
be splitting
seven teams
their quarterback.
The
no, I agree.
Hey, that's a team that we never really talked about for Aaron Rodgers, either. Just
the
saying.
Saints?
Just saying.
He'd probably go to the Saints. I could totally see
I mean,
him
how fun would
Saints
that be? I mean, I got him on the Raiders, but
playing
how fun would it be
Sean
with the Saints?
Payton? Oh, my
Holy
gosh.
Crow.
That would be amazing. Amazing.
Wow.
That would be legendary.
You know, you look at it and you see there'd probably be a better relationship
Thomas?
Between him and Sean Payton. Than
Packers
Gruden,
wouldn't
but,
trade
know.
Him into an NFC team. Yeah. They would not.
Come on.
They would not let him go to an NFC team.
They would not.
Although we thought the 49ers were going to be the first.
There's
first
always
shot at
ways
it.
Around that.
Get him to Denver, right? That's all. Get
all
him out of the league.
Ways a way around that. All right, guys. When we come back, it is time for us to play our Get Home with Hall Financial, where you will have a chance to win a $100 gift card to either Lachiche or Detroit Wing Company. So give us a call, 313-552-6322. It's all sports trivia questions today. So don't be shy. Give us a call, 313-552-6322, because that is up next here on The Hook.
We are here, downtown Fenton, my favorite Bridge Street Exchange.
That's right, and you want to switch up your wardrobe this summer? It's this easy. Ready, Joey?
I'm ready.
All right, you ready? I like it. You want to do it again?
Yeah, let's do it again.
All right. Ooh, Brixton, nice. One more time?
Yes.
Ooh, I like the hat on this one, too. You ready to do it one more time, Joey?
I'm getting tired. One last one.
All right, let's change it. Bro, where's your shirt? You need new clothes this summer. Bridge Street Exchange in Fenton. That's where you need to go. Thank you, guys.
Hey, guys, it's Maz for Hall Financial. Have you had your free Hall Financial 5-minute mortgage checkup yet? If you haven't, what are you waiting on? Get on it. You can get rates in the twos, save hundreds of dollars a month, maybe even save some years on your mortgage. I did. Hall Financial is fast. They do all the heavy lifting for you. So get to DavidHallMortgage.com right now. Tell them Woodward Sports sent you. Tell them The Hook sent you. Tell them Maz sent you, because I've been dealing with them for a long, long time. Hall Financial. Lower payments, better options, more personal attention.
Welcome back to The Hook on Woodward Sports Network. All right, guys, it is time for us to play our Get Home with Hall Financial, where you have got a chance to win a $100 gift card to either Lachiche or Detroit Wing Company, all brought to you by our good friends over at Hall Financial. Fish, who do we have joining us today for our trivia game? Fish? Oh, I guess he's light up the phone. 313-552-6322. Do we have a caller? I thought we had a caller.
It's okay. We'll keep talking.
We do. He's giving me
one.
The thumbs up.
We do. We have a call. It's Nick. He's ready to play some trivia.
Awesome. Hey, Nick. Welcome to the show.
And he's on.
Hey.
Hey, Nick.
Thank you. Hey, Matt. Hey, Vara. D-Mac.
What's
welcome.
Up, Nick? Thanks for coming on, man.
Thanks for calling.
Yeah, no worries. Thanks for having me.
All right, Nick. So you know how to play? All you have to do
is
answer all four questions correctly, and you, my friend, will get a $100 gift card to either Lachiche or Detroit Wing Company, all brought to you by your friends over at Hall Financial. Are you ready for your very first question?
Ready as I'll be.
All right, here we go. Okay. You know, NBA play-in games start tonight, so I'm going to go to Golden State. What city did the Golden State Warriors relocate from? Where did they play before they went out to Oakland?
Would it be San Francisco?
Well, that's where they are. No, San Francisco, Oakland.
Yeah, that's where they are.
Before that,
yeah.
Where were they?
Oakland. Yeah, they were.
This place has got great sandwiches.
Philadelphia.
Nice job,
yes!
Nick.
Yes. Good
Nick,
job.
Are you looking this stuff up, Nick?
No, I go to Philly like 4 or 5 times a year.
All right, cool.
They really right. do have incredible
cheesesteaks. Yeah.
Well, it's a sandwich.
It's a cheesesteak.
I know.
And
it's
pork and...
But if yes. I was to say they've got a really great cheesesteak, then it would really be giving
pork
it away.
Pork roll and a ham sandwich in Jersey?
Pork roll is Taylor ham. Taylor. In North Jersey and South Jersey, it's pork roll.
All right.
It's the same piece of meat, though.
Here we go. Next question, Nick. What college did Steph Curry play for?
Steph Curry played for, it was not San Diego, was it, sorry, I'm trying to think through this.
Come on, brother.
We're going to go with Davidson.
Ding, ding, ding. I was going to say they make really great bikes.
Davidson?
Harley Davidson.
I get it.
That one I got it off.
Davidson, nice.
Okay, you got 7 seconds for this next one.
I'll give you 10. Who was the last Tiger to hit for the cycle? Single, double, triple, and home run in the same game, and it happened in 06.
06, was it, I want to say Damian Easley?
That was a good guess.
Yes.
Nice try, though. Guess. You want to try one more for fun?
Sure.
Go ahead. Hit me. Take another guess.
06 same Tigers. Question. Easley was a good guess.
Ooh, 06 Tigers.
He's an infielder.
Wouldn't have been Polanco. It would have been, Jesus. I can see it. Guillen.
You got it.
Carlos Guillen.
Yes. Nice going, Nick. Nice going, man.
Yep. That 7 seconds got me.
I'm sorry. I put the pressure on you, bro. But you can go get a cheesesteak. Just cut me in on it, all right?
All right. Real quick, I have a question for D-Mac. I'm wondering if I have less teeth than D-Mac. How many teeth have you lost in your career, D-Mac?
All of these. These are all real. These are all fake.
So how many is that? Is that 4?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, about 12.
12?
Yeah.
Okay, you got me by 2. You got me by 2.
Okay, well, right on. So you got the hockey mentality.
Well?
I love it. See, these are all cemented in, bro, because I used to, when I lost this one in 02, I got, first time I ever lost a tooth, I got cross-checked by some Russian in St. Louis, and the worst part is when it shatters, it leaves the nerve.
Oh, God.
So you got to put wax on it. So I had to get a root canal, and they put a post in. But during the 02 playoffs, it kept coming out the post, so I went in during game 3 of the first round against Vancouver, and I took the pliers and ripped it out of my,
the
post
Stop.
Out of my
Stop.
Thing,
Stop.
So it would never be able to be put back, so I didn't have to put it. So then when I retired, I got all new front chompers, and they're
what's worse, that
cemented in.
What's worse, that or cutting off your pinky?
Ugh, you guys are not
they're
right.
Both the same, but here's the thing. When I said put a little bit of little bit of tobacco stain in there or whatever, don't make him look like friggin' Thomas Holmes from Something About Mary's Chompers. I call him Chomper. You see Homer's teeth?
No.
Homer's got the pearliest whites next to Roman Reigns you've ever seen.
So wait, so D-Mac, you've lost 12?
Yeah, I'd say.
Nick, how many have you lost?
10.
I lost 10.
We got 10 between us if we put it all together.
Yeah, you almost have a full set.
How'd you lose yours?
I ate a guardrail going about 20 miles on my bike an hour on my bicycle.
Jeez.
Yeah, man. I bet you that hurt. Mine came out at different times, so I think you win.
You do win, Nick.
Yeah.
I'm glad you're okay, though.
I'm happy you're okay.
Awesome. Thank you.
Hey, Nick, just for having me on the studio. Scars.
I'm glad you were able to pull Davidson out with all that memory loss, hitting that guardrail.
No, he lost his teeth, not his memory,
joking,
Matt.
Man. Joking. Thanks, Nick.
All right, Nick. Have a good one. Hey, keep on listening. Thanks. Appreciate you.
Oh, man.
That suck.
I got to come up with three new questions for tomorrow now.
You're going to be okay. Maz, yes. If you didn't want to have like the world's hardest questions,
this
would be a lot easier.
They're not
hard. I mean,
these ones were good.
These ones were good.
They weren't easy. You know what you should do, Maz? You should give out a theme.
That's a theme. You didn't see what I did? Two questions on Steph Curry and the Warriors. They're playing.
Tigers had a no-hitter.
I talked about Tigers.
I saw the theme. Fish, what do you have for us?
I get the theme of the show, right? But if you give people a theme of the trivia at the beginning of the show, maybe they'd be mindset to call in and be prepared. You know what I'm saying?
Okay, we'll do that tomorrow.
Okay.
Have fun.
Good idea.
That's right. You'll be golfing.
Can we do something where we quiz Maz? We just give him the hardest questions and see if he can get them.
Bring it on.
Yeah, we can, Fish. Bring your hardest
baseball
question.
Wait, are you not with us
question.
Tomorrow?
I won't be here tomorrow.
No, we'll miss you.
I'll be up at the... Where's that Eazy? Where's the... you got that golf where I'm at tomorrow? So one of the big things... Oh, no, not that. Well, I'm doing that tomorrow night, actually. That's an event for... that we're doing tomorrow in Birmingham. I'm actually singing three songs. Roop Raj from Channel 2 is hosting it, and celebrities are getting up there and doing a bunch of things, raising money. But I'll be golfing tomorrow in, up in Frankfurt at the Fortress. We're having the Michigan Memorial for all our warriors and stuff like this, the museum and stuff like that. If you have never been up there, it's such a great memorial to people from Michigan and stuff that have sacrifice their lives for our freedoms and stuff. So I will be up there helping them tomorrow. So I will miss you guys dearly, but I will definitely send you pictures, Maz, and a lot of them will be like this.
I know.
But I'll be rubbing noses. Let me know if you want me to, Tommy Izzo, if you got anything for
the I'd love
to. I gave
somebody
you the list of guys. I gave you your homework, Simon.
I got it. I didn't see Izzo on that list.
Tomorrow, and I'll miss all you guys.
Yeah.
Well, we're going to miss you tomorrow. Maybe Mikey TikTok will fill in.
You never know.
That'd be funny.
There you go. Absolutely. I told him. I tried to get him earlier today. I said, Mike, you can do social media from here. I'll sit in the chair and do the, you know, like we do during the pay-per-views and stuff like that.
Oh, that would have been fun.
Yeah, no, just kidding.
Oh.
I would have done it. Those are comfy chairs, Maz, aren't they?
Heck yeah.
Aren't they the better?
I would sit there in a minute compared to this chair.
I mean these chairs. Listen, once you're in this chair, you're locked in.
The chairs you bought?
I didn't buy them, Fish. I didn't buy them. I got the original text.
Anybody wants to come
and look at my original text, feel free.
Everyone tells me that Joey, they're
full of
shit. Sometimes
sometimes
it's 4K and sometimes it's dial-up.
At least I got us chairs.
Oh, all right, there
guys.
You go. Way to go, Tom.
All right, guys.
Oh, yeah, they were standing before.
When we come back, listen, we've evolved, people. We've come a long way.
We've
come a long way. Listen, I was listening to Mikey TikTok stories about having to hang iPhones from a string for the first couple broadcasts. He's just kidding.
Yeah.
He was just kidding with me. I believed it, but he was just kidding. All right, guys. When we come back, we're going to be talking about the best show on TV.
Well, so says me.
I was going to say, allegedly, to this guy over here. What do you think was the best show on TV? Hit us up on our social media because we're going to tell you what Tom Mazawey says. And I may not disagree.
It's a sports show.
It's a sports show. So you guys, listen, I know everybody wants to say the Golden Girls, and I'm not going to argue that.
Look, Mr. Ed's up there. Batman, of course. Leave it to Beaver. But this one's got him beat.
Sports show. Let us know your thoughts at Woodward Sports or give us a call 313-552-6322 because when we come back,
friends,
we're going to be diving into the best sports show that ever existed right here on The Hook. So don't go anywhere.
So what's up? My name is Sean Baligian. Glad to be a part of Baligian and Bell every day at 11. I'm the guy that gets pissed off at all the stupid sports fans out there.
What up, though? I'm Drake Bell here on the Baligian and Bell show here at Woodward Sports Network. Tap into the energetic Sean and the calm, smooth Drake Bell.
Welcome back to The Hook on Woodward Sports Network. All right, guys, hit us up on our social media at Woodward Sports. Let us know what TV show you think was the best sports show that's ever existed. Tom Mazawey, you're saying Inside the NBA on TNT. Oh, now, we're all big fans
all day long
of TNT around here, aren't we?
Yes, we are.
We love TNT.
We love TNT. Now that, but they didn't get the memo that TNT likes hockey, though.
They do.
And wrestling.
They
just,
I don't get it. But speaking of TNT, you know what's on? Is my favorite tonight before the AW Dynamite's on Wednesday nights. And then I'll be able to watch the NBA on TNT. Obviously, Shaquille O'Neal, Charles Barkley, Kenny Smith, and Ernie. Ernie does such a great
job.
He's
the best.
Isn't he? Because can you imagine having those guys and corralling them with what they do? And they found their vibe. I mean, it is. It's must-see TV. Yeah.
It certainly is. And guess who's getting to do the games tonight? It's going to be Marv Albert and his old buddy, Mike Fratello, the czar of the telestar, is coming back for Marv's last few games before he retires. But last night, if you didn't watch it, it's the first of the play-in games in the East. TNT's got the coverage inside the NBA. It's phenomenal. And you can't miss Shaquille O'Neal, just a great guy, gregarious on the air. He just makes you laugh just by looking at him. You know what a good guy he is. Well, guess what? He was late to the show. So this is how Ernie took us in to TNT's coverage of the NBA.
And from Studio J in Atlanta, TNT NBA tip-off presented by CarMax. Ernie Johnson, Charles Barkley. Great to have Kenny the Jet Smith back.
Indeed, I'm ready for the playoffs.
And it'll be great to have Shaquille O'Neal whenever he gets to the studio.
What kind of dummy misses the first night of the playoffs?
Actually, it's not a playoff game.
I'm FaceTiming him right now. We're going to see if he picks up.
It's the play-in tournament.
Come on, man. Picks up. This is the first night.
Where are you, man? I know.
I'm so excited for this.
It continues to go on from there, and I'm going to take you right in order. How about Shaquille O'Neal trying to sneak onto the set? Yes.
That's just funny. Shaquille O'Neal all big time.
The big Aristotle trying to sneak in stage left. Check this out.
The loser will take on the winner of the Pacers-Hornets game for the number 8 seed. So everybody on board with that? Good. And there he is sneaking in.
Oh, you can't sneak in that stuff.
How can you be that big a sneak?
I apologize. I read my schedule wrong. I'm sorry. I said 6:30. I apologize.
No, I did say 6:30.
I apologize.
You said the game was at 6:30.
Not to be here.
Yeah.
So
that's okay,
I apologize
brother.
To you, Hall of
Fame.
Okay.
That's what happens. We have a Hall of Fame induction ceremony over the weekend, and then you just show up whenever you want.
Let's hear Shaquille O'Neal at the end. Let's hear Shaq. You do your Shaq.
Sorry.
I read my schedule wrong. 6:30.
I read my schedule wrong.
It goes on from there. Now that Shaquille O'Neal is comfy in his chair, focus goes to Charles Barkley because he is going to do a guarantee. Check out Sir Charles Barkley.
But I really, I'm going out on a limb. Ernie, can I do it? I just found out what it is.
What's that?
Guarantee!
Oh, I need one of those.
The Charlotte Hornets are going to win.
Okay. I'm not going to tell you the final score yet.
That was a guarantee, not a darantee. There's a difference.
At halftime, they were down 25 points at halftime. Here is Sir Charles at the half.
I'm going out on a limb. Ernie, can I do it? I just found out what it is.
What's that?
Guarantee!
Oh, I need one of those.
The Charlotte Hornets are going to win.
And with that, we welcome you to our first halftime show of the play-in tournament.
Kiss of death.
Hornets have not led in the game. They trail 69-45. I'll wear this one with you, too, though. I felt good about Charlotte coming in.
The final score was 144-117. That's what Chuck looked like as the game was coming to an end. 144-117. Indiana,
oh my gosh,
without half their team, beat the Hornets, who Chuck guaranteed. I mean, it's such a great show, and I've seen
really
a couple.
I
got Brian on the internet here on social media, and he's got another good one. Another one of my favorites, Hard Knocks. Love.
That's a good one.
Hard Knocks. They're not as good as when it started, when they had the Baltimore Ravens. I don't know how many years ago that they had them, but it was really good then. Each year has kind of gotten, going in. But it's still good. It holds my interest, and I watch every single episode. How about you guys? You got anything that you guys like to tune in?
Yes. Walter's the absolute best on our social media. He says, on my TV, I watch on YouTube as well as on my phone. This show is the best show for me. Walter.
Aww, we love you,
We love you. And hey, man, we're sorry to hear about what's going on with your diagnosis. You know, we love you. And call us. We'll keep your mind sharp.
We'll try.
I don't know.
We'll try.
But we believe that if you keep calling us and we keep your mind sharp, you know, our trivia games, great way to keep the mind going.
We'll keep it sharp. We'll keep it something though, Walter. We'll keep it moving anyways. But that goes out for every other, all the hookers out there.
We
and
love
stuff.
You guys,
we're
man.
We're all in this together. It's a compassion. At the end of the day, it's a human experience. And you know what? We all go through tough times, but we're in this together. So power through, bud. Power through.
We love you. But thanks for thinking that we're the best show for you. We love you. High five to Walter.
Hopefully he'll enjoy the NBA tonight. Two more games tonight, including the Lakers and Warriors, man.
Yes.
And your Spurs against the Grizzlies.
I know. It's gonna be a good night tonight. And then, you know, the Tigers are playing tonight.
That's right.
You're going to have multiple televisions going on. Tigers.
By the way.
Lakers.
Lakers are favored by 5.5. Mac, who you got?
Steph.
You got Steph plus 5.5?
Yeah, all day.
How about you, Eazy?
That's going to throw about 47
Eazy,
down.
You like the 5.5? Well, I think.
That's not my official.
I'm going to ask you. Go ahead.
I only do that sport. We don't watch his picks as my official picks, though. But that's where I go, just hearing off the rip.
Fish, put his mic on, Fish. Go ahead.
Oh, my bad. I got LeBron. Give me the king. All day.
Whoa.
You got LeBron?
Kingness.
Oh, yeah.
King's going to go down with an injury, and he's gonna bow out.
Listen,
I don't think he's willing to fight through.
Suddenly
all
his
the
ankle's
going to
be just fine.
Fight through this season.
I want the Warriors to win. They're not going to win tonight. I think the Lakers will crush them tonight. But the Warriors will beat the winner of the Grizzlies and Spurs.
Book it, Golden State.
I'd like to see Golden State win.
Of course we all want to see them win, except the LeBron lovers.
Right.
Like Stick.
Stick. Oh, Stick. Look at him stirring the pot with you, Stick. Are you a LeBron lover?
Let's go to the morning show, which you can watch from 8 to 10 on the Woodward Network.
Thank
Hi,
you
Stick.
For the plug, Fish. Appreciate that. Nice.
Well, you always get pissed at me when I plug other shows, so I got to plug your show. But you guys don't come on the show as much as the other people on other
shows.
Wait,
let's get back to this. What do I get mad at
Fish,
you?
So you're trying to plug the hook in the afternoon during the morning show, and Stick's giving you shit?
Yeah, I plug the other shows during my time at the 8 to 10.
No, I'm just talking about the hook. I don't care about the other shows, but Stick specifically gives you trouble when you're trying to tell everybody to join us at 3 to 5 because Pilar's here and Maz is going to be all happy and cheery.
I plug your show certain times, and I get some slack from Stick because I don't plug his show.
So he missed.
You know what?
I never give him shit for plugging your show.
Of course not.
I give him shit for never plugging our
show.
Yes, but it leads to other shows.
But do you see how
he gives me stuff for not plugging
our shows? Wait a minute. I just want to point out, this is like the best. You better tell me I'm sorry. I'm sorry because you're making me tell you I'm sorry. This is like the best. Because
I plug other shows on the Morning Wood show, right?
Right.
So he gets angry at me because I don't plug his show.
Because right. Fish, tell them how I end every one of the Morning Woodward shows.
Oh, good call. By introducing the other shows are going on.
Because we're a network here. We're all in this together, baby.
Well, Baligian does that sometimes.
Yeah, because the shenanigans start here every morning on Woodward Sports Network with the Wood. And Stick's not the Wood. That's where Joey comes in. He's half naked all the time, as you can tell. So
Joey's nickname is the Forearm, if you guys didn't know.
The Forearm? Nice. I don't get it.
Think about it, Pilar.
I don't get it.
Think about it, Pilar.
She's still thinking.
His grip strength, because his forearms are like Popeyes, are so big.
Imagine a baby arm holding an apple.
There's a
I still don't get it.
There's a baseball player that's on TV that doesn't that's an analyst.
Stick,
they call
Stick,
him baby arm.
Baby arm. Exactly.
Baby Stick, arm. How about this?
Yeah, just drop it on the table. you getting what we're laying down now, Pilar?
Are y'all being weird?
I guess
that's, that's the same reason why we have a Mikey TikTok.
How about tripod? How about tripod?
Yeah, does that sound good?
Tripod.
What? Why do boys always want to talk about the size of their
I don't want to talk about it. It's just his nickname.
What are you talking
about? I was hosting a nightclub one time, and a stripper came up to me and started telling me about Joey. And then she was explaining to Joey about more than I ever really wanted to know about Joey. And I didn't believe it. I did not believe it. But, you know, it's true.
You get the name Tripod.
How do you know it's true?
I just I got confirmation from multiple women.
Oh,
yeah, guys don't need they. It's through the sources,
yeah.
Like you said, viable source back in the day for stick
stripper
was a stripper was a stripper information line. How do you think him and I became good friends and stuff?
How did this happen? We just went from me hating LeBron James.
That's what happens when you don't come to shows.
LeBron
James. Because you're talking about the biggest stick, you know, LeBron James, right? There it is.
How did this get so derailed so fast?
Like. Ooh. Get that train back.
My work here is done. Thank you, guys.
Thanks, Nick.
So you like LeBron or you don't?
I despise LeBron. I love his talent, but I despise the
His despise meter's right with mine.
Yep. Pilar, so you want...
Pilar, his Tom Brady meter and his LeBron,
yep.
Like, if they could, they are... Except Stick would literally want to physically punch LeBron in just his mouth.
I'd like to make him cry.
Tom would just, like... You know, to
why?
Pour orange juice on his
what
suit.
Did he do to you?
He didn't do anything to me personally. It's the way he handles himself on the court. It's the way he railroads teammates. It's the way he railroads coaches. It's the way he's so self-centered, how he declares himself like the greatest of all time. And we were talking about it this morning. If you're the greatest of all time, you don't have to call yourself that. It's known.
Thank you.
And LeBron has to be like, well, that's when I knew I was the greatest.
It's
like,
well, when you name yourself the king.
Right. Exactly.
I'm just saying.
He didn't name himself
that. The ego gets to me. But with that, he does great things off the court. He builds schools.
Phenomenal
he does all
things.
That stuff.
Yeah.
Big deal.
But I have watched him single-handedly like ruin other people's careers. I've watched him throw coaches under the bus. And it's just not a teammate I would ever want. Period.
I see. Okay. That makes more sense.
Yeah. Talent-wise, through the roof. I'll never
deny
his
talent. And what he does off the court is absolutely phenomenal.
Yeah, that stuff's cool, too. But,
you know,
some of his politics, he's
wishy-washy
on. He'll stand up for something, but at the same time, he won't stand up for certain things. So it's just like, to me, consistency makes the man.
And here's what Stick's saying, is that if it benefits LeBron, then LeBron's going to stand in front of it. You never see... The problem is that are you that way no matter what it is? And I just... I try to be... even or level as far as accountability. I mean, if I get mad at something, it's usually something that I feel about, right? So it's just about the way that it goes about it. And it's just, because you've seen it done by great players. Hey, I'll tell you one. We talk about all the time, Steve Yzerman, one of the greatest human beings of all time. You never hear a peep out of him about his greatness, but
you don't have to. Right. It speaks for itself. And then, you know, you can get into the whole social justice thing with LeBron, how he cares about social justice depending on geography. Because, you know, he signed with Nike. They don't have a lot of great social justice in China. They're actually talking about suspending the Olympics and not doing the Olympics there. And that's a political push from both sides, a bipartisan. But, you know, like that's where I lose respect for people. Like, I need consistency.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where Maz always says is where it sucks is because the hard part is to... You know, when the politics gets into the games and stuff like that, and when you have to look behind it to say what Stick's saying is absolutely true if you're going to live it this way, the accountability. And then to Maz's point, that's a sucky part of sports, but it's a part of life we have to realize. Right.
So that being said, Steph Curry dropped 60 tonight.
I
please.
Hope that would 47, but do we need 60 out of him? He can do it.
He needs to have a 50-point game if they're going to win.
Draymond's going to be big tonight.
Yeah, Draymond's
what's the
over-under
on Steph points? 30 tonight?
Good point.
I don't know what Vegas has him at, but I'm telling you, like, you know, with Clay out, and it's the Steph show. It's Steph versus three Giants tonight. Yeah. And if he wins this game, like, you got to put Steph up there as a clear MVP.
You know, it's so remarkable, even though if he doesn't get it, because that's sort of, to me, the MVP is a popularity contest.
Right.
Sort of,
it
but
is.
To me
I
and
mean,
you and stuff like that, at the size he does and just the way that he's, because the consistency over the last half of the season, too, he's back to his form. And to me, it tells me he's healthy, mm-hmm. right? You know, like, or healthier because... Man, he could go off for 60 tonight.
Yeah.
And as great as LeBron is, Steph Curry changed the league. LeBron did not.
He's a great player in the league. Steph Curry changed the way the entire
phenomenal
league plays.
Player.
Well, you're not, you know what, to your point, look at what Dr. J said. And you know, laying it down, if you don't want to, it's along the same sort of lines as far as why he wasn't in Dr. J's top five.
Yeah.
Right.
And those are your peers that should respect you if you're the greatest. And they don't.
He is minus 320 to be the leading scorer on his team. So you got to lay 320 to win 100. You want to guess who the second player is on the team and what his odds are?
It's got to be Draymond, right?
Draymond's third at plus 5,000.
Ooh, all right.
That means if you put 100, you win 5,000 if Draymond leads the team in scoring. Andrew Wiggins, plus 2,200.
Wiggins got game.
So what a discrepancy. Minus 320 to plus 2,200.
Yeah.
He's a one-man show, like you said.
Yeah.
He's got to win it tonight.
He's got to win it on his own. If they lose, they get the loser. They get the winner of the
the game nobody talks about tonight.
The Grizzlies and Spurs.
Yeah. Nobody mentions that game because nobody cares. It's the LeBron-Steph show tonight.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. I care.
Do you? Oh, San Antonio.
San Antonio. Yeah. So... All right, well, there you have it. Thanks for clarifying that and so much more. I don't know if I'm going to be able to look at Joey the same
Just
anymore.
Look him in the eyes. Don't look down.
Pull tripod.
I'm going to be like, hey, Joey, what's up? And they're going to be. He's going to be like, why can't you
I'll tell you what's
me?
Up.
Hey, and that's
oh, my God. Oh, my God. Hey,
and that,
you know what? Let's get to hack
Joey,
him and
that's
whack
how
him.
The kid in Atlanta got a tryout on.
No. We got to get to your golf segment, my friend.
We could. I mean, it's only
PGA Championship.
Yeah,
it's a major.
A big one.
It's only a major. They only pay four every year.
Let it rip, Eazy.
Hack him and whack him.
Speaking of Joey.
Go to a happy Joey. Oh, my God.
Four. All right. In honor of Sir Joseph Namu and his long driver, this week at the PGA Championship, yes, which one's that, DMAC? Yeah, that's the one that the PGA of America puts on. It's the one that Jordan Spieth is missing in his career all the jackets to win. So if you look at Rory McIlroy, John Rahm, Bryson DeChambeau, and Jordan Spieth, they're all the low money, 12, 14, 16, 100 apiece, right? But this course in Kiawah Island, South Carolina, is 7,800 yards. Mm-hmm. So it's going to be a big ball players game. I'm going to give you a couple on the side to throw a nickel on, right? Mark Leishman, low ball hitter, plays well in majors, plus 6,600. Gary Woodland, put a five on him, U.S. Open winner, plus 10,000. And Tim Pierce.
Oh,
do you know that name? Yes, we do.
Pilar, we know that name. Tim Pierce, the assistant pro over at Birmingham Country Club, where I used to belong, where Pilar's a member now. He qualified for the PGA Championship by sinking a putt at the qualifier. I put $5 on me. He's plus 100,000. You never know.
Five gets you 500 grand. Oh, no, 100 gets you 100 grand. 500 grand. What's
Well, whatever. It'd be great. It would be great. And you
know
what?
I don't
the story is just phenomenal.
25 grand
I mean,
for $5.
Okay. Well, I mean, it's worth
you
trying
You never
to
know. He's
and he's
a great
wearing Woodward
kid.
Sports gear. Joey and Stick brought him Woodward sports gear. He is wearing that on the course.
I don't know if he's able to wear it on the course because I think
he's wearing it right now today.
Okay, Jose. I mean, he's, I know that he's
on the practice round, which is the same thing.
I actually think he is wearing it on the course.
I think he's sponsored by Titleist. I don't know.
He is sponsored by Titleist.
Sponsored by more than one thing.
Yeah, he is sponsored by Titleist.
Yeah, he'll wear the Titleist hat. That'd be awesome.
It'll be interesting.
He's a great kid, and you know what? It's just hometown story. We want to support a local boy. So congrats to Tim. It was an incredible putt.
Best of luck, man.
If you guys get a chance, go Google it. It's absolutely incredible, and it's just it's a great, great story.
He was on the Morning Woodward show last Friday.
Yep.
Yeah.
We saw it.
Yep.
I watched the show, Stick.
That's
I watch it. I watch for you.
I trust you.
I watch
I trust
you.
These people here. I just didn't know if anyone else. The viewers.
I'm not up at that time, Fish.
Yeah, you the viewers may have not missed
way
it.
Way too hard of a life to be up that early.
Yeah, maybe they have work in the morning or whatever. They may have missed it.
Right.
So I wanted to let them know that he was on our show last Friday at 9:40.
I hope Stick hears you plugging the morning show. You can go back and watch it pretty much on demand. So I love that. I hope Stick hears you with the plugs. All right, guys, let's get to a very fast round of who you like to end our show. D-Mac.
Well, I'm taking my 3-0 NHL record for anybody who cares. Just one bet tonight, Carolina and the Caniacs, not the Cocaniacs, the Caniacs get her done in the wild, wild building and rally.
Sounds awesome, man. I got a three-team parlay for you, hit last night. Let's go back with the White Sox, the Padres, and the Reds. That three-team combo gets you $412. So it's a plus 412.
All right, Eazy, who you like?
I like Carolina and the Lakers.
All right, Fish, who we like? Aside from Tim Pierce.
We do like him. You're going to the Cowboys. You're going to Australia. You're going Cowboys overnight. As much
Thursday
as I want to say. Yeah, as much as I want to say F the Cowboys, I think they're going to beat the Knights. They're at home.
Holler.
So they should have home field advantage. And then
it's
New
the
Zealand,
world's team.
New Zealand Breakers are finally back home after 440 days of not being at home. They're playing Sydney. They're going to probably lose.
That's
but they're
going to
win
way.
In my heart.
Nice. Yeah.
All right, guys. There you go. So those are our picks for tonight. Hey, big thanks to Pete for giving us a call. Dan Dickerson, we love you. Thank you so much for joining us.
Nick called us.
No, Pete called us in the beginning of the show, remember?
Right.
But I'm going to say, I have him all
I'm
written
sorry.
Down here.
My bad.
All written down here, okay?
My bad.
Nick, thanks so much for
Maz, you
calling.
Suck.
You don't suck. Stop hitting yourself.
Stupid. Stupid, Maz. You want me to go hit him before he pulls up?
No. Stop the violence. Stop.
Before we go, my favorite part of the promo for the hook is that part. Hi, it's Maz. We suck. You suck.
Oh,
my favorite part.
Suck.
Hey, don't forget Morning Woodward tomorrow, 8 to 10.
That's right.
Baligian and
Nick,
Bell, 11 to 1.
And Nick, thanks so much for calling in and
thanks,
giving
Maz.
It a try with our Get Home with Hall Financial. For Jeff on our social media,
for
Walter,
Fish,
right for Walt. Easy D, for Walter. We love you, Walter.
Walt.
We love What was that?
He knows.
I see
Walt
you.
Knows.
Walt knows. All right. I
Deuces.
See you.
Mills Lane.
For Tom Mazawey. For D-Mac. I'm Pilar. We'll see you guys
and
tomorrow.
And Joey's baby arm.
Y'all weird.
Tripod.
It was shorter than anybody thought. Was this fellow right here, and that's why he deserved the trophy.
Okay, John, I know.
He took the game away from him.
I know you'd like to congratulate the other members of the Islanders. Oh. I want to just ask a couple of questions of Billy Smith. You mentioned you related to the controversy that you seemed to cause. Tell us about the major penalty to Anderson.
Well, I did the same thing that Gretzky did to me to draw five penalties out. When I hit Gretzky in Edmonton, he rolled around and cried like he was dying. So when he hit me tonight, I says, hey, I may just as well do the same thing. So that's what I did. I threw myself on my back and I squirmed. Incidentally, he got 5 minutes. So all I want to tell the people in Canada and all over the world, two can play that game.
After game three, I asked you who you thought should win this. You named Bob Bourne.